at this podcast, the best of the underground. Make madness your ritual.
Oh shit.
Hey,
everybody knows what time it is, right? It's fucking a little after 9 o'clock on fucking April Fool's Day.
Time to get ill.
Ritual Madness Podcast, episode 127. Do me a favor and check out ritualmadnesspodcast.com. On the right side, you'll be able to connect with us on a multitude of links. iTunes and Stitcher, both podcast applications. One is for the fucking Apple garbage, and the other one is for Stitcher, which is also Apple garbage, and the droid garbage, all that other good shit. Excellent podcast applications. You can check us out on there, Ritual Madness Podcast. Social media, Facebook, Ritual Madness Podcast on Facebook, Ritual Madness MN on Twitter, Ritual Madness Podcast on Instagram, and a YouTube channel, which is full of shit right now. I've got a couple episodes up there right now, but I have a backlog of three or four video podcasts that I have to work around YouTube's fucking copyright infringement issues right now. So it's kind of a bullshit channel right at this moment, but keep in touch. We'll definitely try to get that figured out. Do me a favor and download the Listen to My Radio application. That's LISTE and the number 2, My Radio. And once you get to the search bar, push in Ritual Madness Podcast and bookmark that bitch. And every time you want to listen to the radio station that we got going here, 365, 24/7, all that other good shit. And right below that, there's a little Amazon link. If you shop Amazon, do me a favor, click that Amazon link, bookmark it as your own. Every time you buy something off of Amazon, it kicks back a couple pennies at no cost to you. Below that, there's a little donation button. If you're feeling generous, please donate to the podcast. Help us keep things going. If you're in a band or you have friends that are in bands, tell them to quit playing and go home and fucking stay in their closet. No, submit your material at ritualmadnesspodcast@gmail. ritualmadnesspodcast@gmail. Also, do me a favor and check out DOTW Pod. That's the Disciples of the Watch podcast. Very cool cats. DOTWpod.com. Also, Sunday mornings, The Root of All Evil show. It's been around since the 90s. You guys got to check it out on Fresh Air Radio, KFAI. That's The Root of All Evil. Also, I wanted to let everybody know, May 7th, Ritual Madness Podcast is going to do their very first show of monthly madness here. May 7th at Lee's Liquor Lounge, featuring Mortificator, Blood War, Sin 7, and Psymothwa. Also, Lowbrow Tattoo Saints is donating $300 worth of tattoo gift cards that we're going to raffle off. $2 Jack and Cokes all night. And $3 PBR Tall Boys, so come down and have a good time. It's going to be our first show, putting it together, trying to get the scene back to where it was in the fucking the late 90s, early 2000s. Going to do a lot of metal down there. I'm going to fucking try to put it together, and hopefully this all works out. So just show some love, support, all that other good shit. Again, you're listening to Ritual Madness Podcast, episode 127. Hanging out with the guys from Mastiff, man. You guys just got here. How's it going, fellas?
Great.
Fucking horrible.
Pretty good. We started out with some obituary. Slowly we rot. That's fucking awesome. You're having a shitty day. Why are you having a shitty day, man?
I was just joking.
Oh, you're just setting the mood.
Yeah,
you got to set the mood for downright fucking.
Right now, my girlfriend's going, oh, shit. Making ass of him.
He's going to come home and be.
No, I'm actually having a great day.
Awesome, dude. Awesome.
We've listened to our CD a couple times today as a band and sat and had beers together, and we're doing this right now and hanging out with some label dudes, and, you know, it's cool. It's a good
label
day.
Label dudes. Gotta love that.
I got to use my AK.
There you go. Nice. Well, let's go around the table and tell the people who you are and what you do in the band.
Aaron Ryan, play the drums.
I'm Aaron Limatainen, I play the guitar.
Neil on bass.
Kevin, guitar.
I'm Al, vocals.
Vocals. Al's been on here a couple times, fucking.
Yeah, this is a hat trick three. I'm not good at baseball.
Yes, it's three.
I don't know how many touchdowns you have to get in the third period.
That's it. That's a triple-double.
So this is my hat trick. Yeah. This is my third time.
Yes. Yes, sir. So in this room, we actually have fucking many, many years of Minnesota metal experience in this room.
In each chair.
So many years. Now, Al, how many years have you been in the scene here?
Well, I guess I got my first show with Decker when I was 12, and I'm 40. So if you carry the three, that's like 60-something.
Oh, no. 40.
That's a long, long time. So yeah, from 12 years old is my first metal show, and I'm still doing it now. So
right.
Yeah.
That's a lot. That's a long time. How about you, Kevin? How long you been in the scene?
Since like 95, 96.
You got to get up on that microphone, dude.
95 or 96.
Yeah.
See, if you can't taste what I ate for dinner, then
I don't want to taste.
How about you, Neil? How long you been in the scene, buddy?
About 15 years or so.
15? That's it? Yeah. He's the young buck in the room? No way, dude.
Yeah, I think about 15 years.
No, it's been longer than that.
It's under,
dude.
20.
it's close, man. Well, if you're fucking trying to round it, you're going to 20. You're closer to 20 than you are to 10.
Let's say 20.
You're round down by 10.
How about you, Aaron? What?
I've been doing this since about 98 when I was in high school up in Esco. First band was Zephaniah with Kevin Fisher.
Get up on the microphone, please.
Kevin Fisher.
Yeah.
For Miasis. So yeah, I've been in the scene for quite a while now. Moved down to the cities in 2001, and I'm still here, so.
Must be doing all right, then.
Doing all right. Having fun.
Fucking makes bank.
There you go. There you go. How about you, Aaron? How long you been around?
Way too fucking long. At
45.
The ripe age of 45. I started out right out of high school, right out of the gate in 1988. I joined a little band called Impaler.
Nice.
And played my first show with them. At First Avenue in the main room, and nearly shit my pants. So.
That's a good time to shit your pants.
Yeah,
for sure.
I don't know. That prevents it.
At least there was plastic everywhere.
Do that or puke.
Yeah,
because that was. I mean, I went to so many shows at First Avenue when that screen goes up, and to be on the other side on the freaking drum riser.
Fucking A, dude.
When it was, you know, the intro music's just freaking pumping, and as it's going up, it's just. You know, a crowd of people on the main floor, and then people lined up all the way on the railing.
Fuck yeah, man.
Fucking nuts, man.
Yeah. Awesome. That is insane, man. That's definitely a feeling that you'll never forget, man, when you've done it. I remember the first time that I got on that stage, I kissed the stage. I was like, this is everybody that I ever.
That's gross.
It is gross because there's probably lots of vomit and urine and fucking cock and whatever. Ass.
Yeah.
How many sweaty asses were on there?
And what's funny is there actually probably is cock and ass germs.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Oh, yeah.
Most definitely.
Literally.
On the Danceteria nights when they're fucking dropping the bombs. So what's going on with Mastiff? What's what are you guys here for?
We're not really sure. We had it written down, but.
We got a new CD coming out.
Nice.
Yeah.
What's the title of the new CD?
From the Ash of Elders.
From the ass of elders.
Yeah.
From the ass of Elvis.
The ass of Elvis.
From the ass of Elvis. Elvis.
Patent pending, our first mock shirt.
That's fucking...
Damn it.
Hot shower.
Nice. So how'd you guys come up with that title?
I don't know.
Not the Elvis one, the ashes of elders.
I don't know. Just, you know, getting normal, and I come up with words that sound cool together, and I try to make them mean something, and... basically, it's just supposed to represent, like, paying homage and respect to our forefathers of metal and death metal.
Hell yeah.
You know, all the dudes we grew up with, like, you know, we were just talking about being old, and I don't know. We think we got a newer and kind of unique sound, somewhat, kind of, but we also have, like, some Obituary and a little bit of Carcass and, you know, some old school cats in our sound, so.
We love our thrash.
Yeah, we're old school guys at heart. We're all pretty much considered old by today's standards. So
right.
From the Ash of Elders is just like, you know, trying to pay homage to the old school, but yet do something new with it.
Sure. Absolutely, man. Absolutely.
Some other stuff in junk.
So how'd you guys come up with the name Mastiff?
Really, our old drummer Brad and I were kind of bouncing ideas back and forth, and I was working at the Humane Society for quite some time at that point, and we kind of wanted to go with an animal theme, or naturistic.
And Chihuahua wasn't the fucking...
No, Chihuahua sounded brutal because those guys are like the most badass, yeah. But it was long, and we didn't want people mispronouncing it.
Chihuahua?
And it was a long... When Christoph did the logo for it, it was like it didn't fit on the shirt,
right.
So... no, so, you know, I was just It was as simple as just thinking of all the different dog breeds. I thought a dog breed would be a cool way to name a band. And,
right.
And, you know, Pitbull is that the dumb rapper guy. And
yeah.
I don't know. There wasn't a whole lot that sounded cool.
I was just going to bust into a Pitbull song, but I just realized I can't fucking...
I don't know. I couldn't rehearse any of that. And I got by Mastiff, and I was just like, oh, that sounds cool.
Yeah.
It just kind of rolls off the tongue. Sounds metal.
Right.
Turns out there's like three other ones.
Right.
But, you know.
Four or five.
Yeah. Well, there's two that are really cool.
And I mean, you guys released Bully Breed for like pretty much right after you guys got together, right?
Bully Breed, that's Legion.
Oh, it is.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
And technically, it's an old and Hope to Die song.
Oh.
Will and Lonick's old band.
See,
and
Legion remade. What a horrible
that.
Fucking host! I'm fucking talking about one of your other bands.
Awkward.
What was the first track that you guys released like right away after you
we
guys
did,
got together?
It was a Chum.
Bottom Feeder.
That's the one I was thinking of.
Yeah. Bottom Feeder was our first one.
Yep.
And you know
that's the one I meant.
To be fair, you have 2/5 of We Are Legion in the room.
There you go.
At the moment, so and if you listen to the Sweet Taste of a Bitter Revenge off the new CD, it does have kind of a Bully Breed feel to it.
Ah, gotcha.
So and you'll know that when the CD comes out, but we're not playing that one tonight.
Well, that's cool that you guys were kind enough to bring in some tracks to play to debut them on the show. I really appreciate that.
I think what you mean is desperate enough.
Desperate
to
enough
bring some tracks in.
Please, Greg.
Greg, please.
Please.
Play our shit.
No, it actually worked out pretty well, man, because I planned on, you know, getting you guys in. I didn't know how soon you guys were going to be ready to go, and then all of a sudden, because we were going to do a local podcast and just play a bunch of local stuff tonight, and with Gooch and Carrie having their issue tonight, right. he wasn't going to make it anyway, so it'd probably just be me in this room fucking jerking myself off, you know, watching porn in between the sets.
It was meant to be.
Yeah.
The atmosphere will be the same.
Yeah. It's going to be the same.
It worked out good.
So basically, we're all going to jerk off in between music sets?
Yeah, yeah.
Awesome, dude.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can't wait, dude. I can't wait.
As far as being ready, we're never going to be ready.
So how long has it taken you guys to put this thing together? As far as like, I mean, where was the idea to come together with Mastiff?
From inception?
Yes.
Almost 3 years? I'm horrible with dates and stuff, but am I close to that?
Now, Kevin, you and Brad jammed together in Opaque back in the day, right? And that was kind of the precursor to this whole deal too. And you guys jammed with Opaque for quite a while, and then it just kind of you guys separated and went to different bands and different things. And I imagine it was him giving you a call, going, "Hey, Kevin, you want to jam again?"
Yeah, that is totally how this started. It was supposed to be
pull that mic up towards you.
The like benefit that. Show for Rural Root.
Yeah,
that Opaque was asked to play. So
sure,
that's the whole reason we got together.
Right,
and then we didn't play it, or something happened where we weren't on the show. And he's like, "Well, my drums are here. Want to do something?"
Sure.
I'm like, "Yeah."
Right.
So that's kind of how it started. Just him
Magic.
And
I. Sure. No, so it was just you two, and then it kind of steamrolled from there.
Yeah, then I was we were at Club Underground where we were having our CD release show, and I was talking to Kevin, and we were talking.
Which what band were you in at that point?
I wasn't in a band
at
the time. This one at Endville broke up.
Okay.
And Kevin, we were talking, and I was like, he was like, "You're going to be in another band?" I was like, "Well, if I'm going to be in another band, I want to be in a band with you because our guitar styles."
Right.
I mean, we feed off each other.
Sure.
I mean, just great.
Like this, you guys feed each other like this and shit. Like,
he makes an important point.
Get into the microphone, fucker. You're not talking.
No, I'm saying
Heavy just made an important point that he should repeat.
What's that?
That this show that in question was an Outside the Murder show.
Oh, nice, man.
And we were like looking at each other, saying we want to do something fucking heavy.
Nice.
And so inspiration, that was my point, but nice. I wanted you to say it, you dickhole.
I said it, but
it just
talking.
Went in passing. It went in passing there. Well, that's pretty cool, dude. That's pretty awesome. So you guys just decided, you know, hey, let's get together, you two together as far as guitar playing.
Yeah, well, they were already jamming. I mean, Brad already has drums down there, and I just brought my gear down to try out, and it just clicked.
Sure.
Yeah, and we were literally like working on the first song still at that point.
Right.
So
that's awesome, dude.
Pretty infant at that point.
Right. And then how Al, how did you get involved with them? Did Did they say we need one of the most badass singers in the town, or how did that work?
That is absolutely not what happened.
They wanted you to do rap.
No, I believe you guys were talking about doing
Biscuit covers?
A tribute, like a covers project, like Obituary and shit like that at first, right? With Brad. And I wanted in on that. Once in a while, I can pull off a cover voice once, you know.
Sure.
If I got the right liquor. And so I was hoping for it. Ended up becoming an original project, and I don't know, I just kind of suckered myself into it.
Sure.
I suckered them to let me into it.
So Brad was playing drums.
Yep.
You got to two guitar players right off the bat.
Yep.
Who was doing bass at that particular time?
Nobody. Neil was the first.
I was the first.
Oh, insisted on Neil. Neil's the only bass player I've ever wanted to play with. So
he popped that chair.
Yeah, I'd roll around on the floor like a toddler when I don't get... I got Neil in both my bands.
Nice.
Because I whined like a little baby, so it works. It's what works for me.
Now, you guys played together in Six.
Six, yes.
Yes, right.
Yep, the original incarnation of Six.
God, I remember those ball gag.
The saran wrap.
Dude. Just fucking.
It's gross.
I remember you walking by and I just smacking your ass
a couple times.
And you're just like, hold your bass, go, hey, just fucking walking by. Dude. It's some of the greatest shit ever. Just, you just see
I
a
had
fucking,
no shame back in
just
the day.
Just a fucking beanbag hammock right there and a fucking ball gag in his mouth and fucking.
It was gross.
Awesome.
Dude, it was the best shit ever, man. Nobody else was doing that in the town, man.
No one
was
fucking.
I wasn't even sure he could play bass at the time. I was just happy to have him in the band.
Love it.
Just to watch his beanbag.
Yeah, just
shit.
To like look at that guy over there, man. these people are not here for us. They're here for him.
Just
still
so you
true
know
to
that,
this day.
That image is still fucking burnt into my fucking head, man. That just shit is.
The image burnt in my head forever of Neil, and I might even tell this at my wedding. I don't know. We were on our way to Iowa to play a show or something.
Yes.
When that family came up by us and they were giving us dirty looks on the right-hand side.
Oh, yeah.
Al, should I slap my shit up on the window? He did. And it was like, you know, like those hands that you get out of the vending machine.
It
was just
hands.
Like that. And it's like burned in my memory forever. And there was like, they weren't kids. They weren't underage, but they were young enough to be a little freaked out. You know, and it was a family that were really conservative looking. But they were giving us dirty looks and like pacing us and like being dicks, you know. So it took care of it.
Dude, the straight flasher.
That'll be one of my last memories on my deathbed.
That's fucking awesome, dude.
It was great.
That's.
Yeah. Fucking mushroom stamps the window and shit. Hey, look at me! Hey, look at me! There you go, dude.
Yeah, nobody else in the car liked that, though.
Were you guys all like, oh?
We didn't know what to think. We're like, gut it, dude. Get out of here, quick.
They're fucking.
No one had cell phones back in the day. It was good.
What were what were you guys driving in that particular time? We got to make an APB out on that shit.
Who knows? some four-door something or other horrible.
Amber alert. There was a fucking man smuggling a sausage. It's hilarious, dude. That's so awesome. This was in Iowa?
I'm almost positive we were on our way to Iowa.
Yeah, it was.
I've
fairly,
got a horrible memory though, so I could be making it up. Was it? Yeah, sure.
Dude, we'll you go know with that. There's a guy who's a full grown man at this particular time, and every time he fucking sees a dude, he's like a fucking driving like. He's gonna
anytime
see a fucking
he comes up next to a
splatty hand winky on the fucking window and shit.
Have you ever seen a grown man naked?
Oh, that's great. Oh, that's fucking excellent. Oh, that's a great story right there. So you guys, I mean, so what bands were you guys all in periodically? Well, let's go around the table and kind of list the bands off of what everybody's been in here.
That's is that considered a loaded question?
No.
Because you know.
I know.
You know my past.
But I want everybody who may be a new listener.
Don't Google or YouTube any of this, but I was in a band called Catharsis.
And you were 12 at that time?
Yeah, I was 12 in Catharsis. Yeah. I don't know if there's any video of that. We played at an elementary school. I think they filmed it.
Yeah.
It was pretty disturbing. They sat Indian style in like Indian style. Remember that?
Oh, yeah. It's native style now,
yeah,
dude.
Nah.
Bro.
Native style. And a band called Release, which was like the OG rap core, you know, 612 crew back in that day and all that. Limp Bizkit's first shit.
Yeah.
And
you were before that shit, though.
was in a band called Plague of Hate. Yeah, we were before Limp Bizkit. We were right before. Well, when $3 Bill came out. I was like, wow, you can scream and do metal and rap at the same time.
I'm doing this.
And I was
shit.
Into Tupac and Cypress Hill and, I don't know, some decent, you know, shit.
Yeah.
Onyx, I don't know, white boy rap.
Beastie Boys.
So we got into it. Boys. What about you, Heavy?
What's your band?
Well, Opaque, and then there were...
Was that your first band as Opaque?
Well, I mean, there were different renditions of basically that same band.
Sure.
Up until then. None of them worth really mentioning.
Yeah.
And then...
We're all so proud of our past.
All right.
This land, well... And all the renditions of that, right? Tarantula Gardens, whatever. And then Mastiff.
So. Weren't you in Expire for a little while, too?
Expire, too.
Yeah, you forgot one.
There you go.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Sober,
too.
Damn you, dude. You need to drink more to get your memory back and shit.
He needs another Surly.
That's good, man. That's good. Well, how about you, Neil? Let's go.
I started with Steve Wolf.
Mm-hmm.
That was my first real band where we played out. yes, the first rendition with Jay Summers and Sean McNabb on drums. But after that, I got in touch with Al, and we started up Six shortly after that. Ran that for a couple of years, and I did...
There were a bunch of incarnations of that shit, too.
Oh, right? Yeah. There were so many guitar players. There was probably... 15 by the time I was gone.
Kyle Skoquist from Impaler was our guitarist for a little while.
That's right. That's right.
And Alex Kelly from Reaping as Medea.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
And that was before he became a fucking retarded guitar player.
Right? Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he was a good guitar player back then, but when he fucked his head up and came back.
In our band.
Oh, yeah.
Our band was like practice for his future because he just sat and noodled. And we were just like, that kid's going to do something cool.
Right. He's a fucking
and he
freak,
did,
dude.
You know.
He's a freak for sure.
Yeah, then I did This Will Not End Well with Kevin and Aaron and Steve again, and eventually after leaving This Will Not End Well, I started up with We Are Legion with Al again, just because I can't stay away from Al.
I'm attractive.
It's a fucking man. It's a man crush right there.
You complete me, Al. You complete me.
I compete you.
Dude, there was some serious fucking twiddles of the fingers right there, man. That was like an
Sparks,
autistic moment
boy,
right there.
Sparks.
No. I thought that was an autistic moment.
We usually hold hands on the
definitely
radio.
Asperger.
Nobody knows that. But.
Oh, it's, you know how it is. You know, you get to feel tight with the musicians.
Oh, yeah.
And even if they're, you know, you... And get away from each other for a while. You want to get
sex.
Back, and
it's never the same, man. When you, I mean, it's always good as a musician to you know spread yourself out and enjoy jamming with other people. But when you hit that niche with somebody, mm-hmm. and you're just like, this fucking works. You know, you know where that person's going. You know how they write, how they feel when it. You know, you rub their bottoms and fucking you know undercarriages and shit like that.
Playing grab ass.
Yep.
Touch each other's nipples.
Yep. Things like that. How about you, Aaron? What bands were you in, sir?
I was in a band called Zephaniah up in Duluth. It was my first band. And then I came down to the cities. I was in a band called Syndrome. And then I met Neil, and we brought back Dim with Steve Wolf.
Right.
And it was with Steve Wolf, Neil Pruitt, and James Monty, who was a singer in Zephaniah, and he played drums. And then from there, we kind of like joined, like we put like Tarantula Gardens and Dim together,
mm-hmm.
and then we formed This Not End Well. And after that, it was Mastiff. That's pretty much my story.
Nice.
Shitty.
How about you, Aaron? You did say Impaler
for
your very
first. Yes, I start off with Impaler right out of high school. How much time do we got?
Go ahead, man. Okay. We got time.
History.
All right.
Give him a history lesson.
All right. After Impaler, I played with another band called Smash Palace for a little stint. And then I kind of derived into heavier music. And then I remember seeing an ad in City Pages saying something about, you know, Pantera, Forbidden, Violence, blah, 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 blah. And that turned out to be Walt Borgen from, with Avalanche. And I hooked up with Avalanche and John Stunner and the Borgen Brothers, and that was pretty cool.
So, amazing musicians.
Yeah, I've been very fortunate. Like, every band I've been with have been outstanding fucking musicians. So Avalanche was really cool.
How long were you with those guys?
I was with them for about 4 years or so. And then that kind of ran its course. And then I had my first child, and I kind of took a little break after that.
Sure.
And I did some stuff with some friends from high school and stuff. We did like some rhythm and blues stuff. But then after that, I wanted to get back into playing music again. I hooked up with some friends of mine, and I played in this band called Complex Zero, and shared a practice space with Bane Hinge, and we played shows with Bane Hinge and stuff, and those guys were badass. So Jason and Chad,
yeah, good dudes for sure.
And then
Sexual Dynamos.
Yeah, and then after that, kind of took another little hiatus, and I just wasn't doing anything. And I heard a friend of mine was saying this band Mastiff was looking for a drummer.
Which friend was that?
That was Jason that? Horn.
Jay Horn.
Yep.
Yeah.
Jay Horn.
And then
Obituary Ruler.
I listened. Yeah. To, I listened. I
went to high school with him, dude. Yeah. He had a fucking leather jacket with the fucking Cause of Death logo on the back of it.
Yeah, that, it in fact, badass. When I first
somebody
met
stole him, that shit from him, right?
When I first met him, it was at an Avalanche after party, and he had that jacket, and I'm like, dude, that is the fucking sickest shit I've ever seen.
Dude, he had it forever.
And that's how we hooked up.
Yeah.
And you know.
So he turned you on to these knuckleheads, huh?
Dude, I've been friends with that guy for over 20 years. And then yeah, he
I'm sorry.
Yeah, well, yeah, I know. And then yeah, I remember he went and saw Mastiff when they played at the Hexagon, and I was stuck at work. He fucking bailed early because he was a fucking lead. He's a dick. And he came back, and I saw the fucking shirt he had. It was like the fucking Mastiff. It was just sick as fuck. I was just like, whoa, that is fucking cool. I mean,
I was really jealous when you guys came out with that fucking shirt, because I was like, God damn, that is a badass fucking shirt.
That was Brad. He found that on Facebook, found some badass artist. Not even a metal artist, just somebody that happened to be the one metal design.
Yeah. And he told me all the you know, he said Al Town from Legion's in it, you know, Neil Pruitt from Legion, he told me Kevin and Limo were in it, and I'm like, yeah. And I'm like, well, I was also with Day Zero before Mastiff.
Right.
I was jamming with those guys, you know, getting their stuff started. Sure. And
drunk bastards.
I kind of had a project at the time, and Jason's like, well, check out the fucking YouTube video and fucking tell me what you think. And it was Bottom Feeder, and I was just like, fuck, that's right, fucking some heavy fucking shit.
Yeah,
I'm like, that's pretty fucking.
So how long were you not playing at that particular time?
Or
were
you still? It was a good like 6 or 7 years. So right. I had to bust the rust off a little bit to get fucking back in the game.
Now transitioning from Brad to Aaron must have been you know, with him having a bit of rust, and then, you know, seeing Aaron play and seeing Brad play, two different styles of drumming, you know what I mean? Like, not to take anything away from Brad, because Brad, you know, he's a great songwriter, and he's got a lot of good ideas.
He's handsome.
He puts things, you know, he dissects them, puts them together and pulls them apart. And he's very good at
you can see the whole picture.
Yeah. He could definitely do that. Now, how was the transition between those two drummers?
I think they're, like you said, they're very, very different drummers, but, I'm a giant fan of both drummers.
Right.
You know, whatever we had with Brad is in the past, but I've always maintained that anytime he's ever come up in conversation, how much of a fan of his drumming style.
Oh yeah.
Just the way he hits.
Sure.
He's just fucking awesome. And that was a big concern of mine. Like,
sure.
You know, when we parted ways, like, how the fuck are we going to replace this dude?
Right.
And it was frustrating, and I didn't see a whole lot of hope, even with the oversaturation of Minnesota metal scene. You know, it's like
still, but drummers are hard still, to come by, man.
Yeah, and more if you're particular a drummer, you're a commodity. About yeah. a drummer.
I have mad respect for Brad because I played shows with Opaque with Kevin when I was in Avalanche.
Sure.
I mean, I've seen Brad play. He's very, very good drummer.
He's a badass and very, very tight. And then and then when you know I heard about Aaron wanting to come down. And he came down knowing a few songs, and he just pretty much came down and killed it. Just nice. Destroyed it.
That's awesome.
Again, very different style, but later, buddy.
Later, right. Chris. Wow.
Right.
Yeah, he played bottom feeder and just fucking nailed it right
first
in the
time.
Pocket. Yep.
Just
and,
nailed it.
And I was like, you know, it's a different style. It's more straightforward, but it still works.
Right.
I looked
it
at
still
Kevin.
Works. Even with the same songs, it still works.
Right then, I
yeah,
knew.
We all kind of grinned.
We found our drummer.
And we're like, fuck yeah, sweet.
That's awesome.
Done.
That's a transition, like that. Man. That's really tough to do. Yeah. I know when Brad when we split with Brad and Outside the Murder, because you know Brad basically him and I started Outside the Murder and put it together, and just like you guys, I mean,
yeah,
he helped
start Mastiff.
You know, we wrote those songs together, every single one of them. Even you know when we recorded that album, that pretty much you know 95% of I would say 85% of that stuff was written with Brad. And the drummer that came in, like, you know, you want to give people enough space to do their own stuff and, like, you know, interpret the
but
music.
But at the same time, you're like, well, the
dude,
last guy did
right
this really
this.
Cool
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, yeah, you got to, you know, and even, you know, our drummer now, he was like, you know, Greg Brown was like, fuck, what is he doing there? I don't even understand what he's doing there, you know, and he had his own nuances. But, yeah, you know, it's such a different transition when you're trying to fill that spot. It's different, you know. Guitar players are... You know what I mean? It's kind of the...
You guys just make dumb noise. It's easy to...
yeah.
You guys are stupid. It's just simple. Just
doodly, doodly, doodly,
puke in a distortion box yep. and...
yeah, it wasn't just Jason Horn, though. I was listening to Ritual Madness podcast, and I think it was either the Legion one, and Will and Al were talking at Mastiff needed a drummer. And,
nice.
And, yeah...
Well, that's good, man.
At least
it's kind of doing
I mean,
its job.
Because you had you all know? My friends, my old singers, my old guitar right. players, I mean, my old bands.
Right.
I love that shit.
That's
so
awesome, dude.
I mean, I heard that, and I was just like, fuck, I better... And Slayer Mike's and Bella's wedding was coming up, and I knew I'd run into someone.
Right, right.
I know you were there.
Right, yep.
And a bunch of, you know, Kevin and Lee were there. So I started talking with Kevin and Lima at the bar, and I remember Lima going, I think we found our new drummer.
That's awesome. That's awesome. That's awesome, dude. So, well, let's play some more tunes. We got the very first debut tune from the new Mastiff album.
Oh, shit.
Hell yeah.
What is this one called?
I believe this is aphotic.
Yep.
Yeah.
Which, in case you're curious, is just to grow in the absence of light, and that's kind of... thematically the lyrics, the subject. So pay close attention to the lyrics and make sure to follow along and
yep.
sing along.
Follow the bouncing ball.
Because you'll understand everything.
Make a lyric video while you're doing it.
Yeah, yeah, don't do that.
Take the song, make a lyric video, put it up on YouTube, make it cool.
We actually are. Not with this song, we'll do a different song.
That's awesome, dude. And then after that, we've got, let me see here, we've got some Goat Whore. We got some Gwar, and then we got some Goat Whore and some Meshuggah. I wanted to kind of ask you guys, what is it, when we started with Obituary, what is it about Obituary that kind of, that brought this one, brought it, why'd you bring this Obituary with you?
That was my personal choice, to try to summarize as much as a singer possibly can. Obituary, to me, is one of the heaviest bands on the planet still.
For sure.
And kids will disagree, and that's not heavy, and that's dad metal, whatever.
They're
Obituary
stupid.
Is fucking heavy. They're one
stupid.
Of the heaviest bands on the planet. One of my biggest influences when it comes to actual groove and heaviness. Not only that, they were one of the first actual death metal bands I'd ever heard as a kid.
Right.
And learning his mumbles on the cassette tape of Slowly We Rot was like my first experience as like vocal, death metal vocalist. And so that this song... specifically means a lot to me as one of the first songs I ever heard. Then I got the cassette tape and it was over from there.
How about the Gwar? How did you guys?
It's just my favorite band.
Yeah.
I've always loved them. I don't know how what to even how to explain it. I just, right. This is one of those bands.
They're fucking amazing.
Oh, God.
Yeah. They're fucking amazing. They've always been amazing. And then Goat Horror. What do we got? What about Goat Horror?
Oh, that was my choice. I just love them. I love Sammy's guitar playing.
Yeah.
Anything he's ever done with Acid Bath, just awesome.
That's right. Amen, you hear it, motherfucking Acid Bath. I love when someone comes in here and they know that shit right there, because that is the epitome of what Goat Horror is. It is Sammy. He writes that shit, and it is so fucking heavy. And all I watch him play to this day, dude, in every album that he plays on, that's all I hear is fucking Acid Bath riffs. Like, all right, if it was Dax, if it was Mikey, if it was fucking, you know, Audie and all them guys in that room instead of everybody else on stage, it would be fucking Acid Bath, because the riffs are fucking amazing. And the wah, fucking screams. Oh, dude, he's amazing.
And really,
big boner.
When you do actually get to listen to the full Mastiff CD, I guarantee you will hear some Sammy influence, not to mention Obituary and a few of these other bands we're playing here tonight.
Fuck yeah, dude. That's
you're going to hear that in our CD.
That's the whole idea of having, you know, the bands pick their songs, and I always try to tell people to pick stuff that inspires them to write what they are, man. You guys follow directions. Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
We got one thing right so far.
Then we got some Meshuggah after that. How about that one?
Well, I think we're all, I don't know, if I could probably speak for the entire band. We just all fucking love the Odd Meter. We touch on Odd Meter a little bit on our CD.
You got to see Neil's Odd Wiener? Is that what he said?
It curves to the left.
Way to the left.
Then to the right.
Way to the left.
It goes, meow, meow.
No, but just Meshuggah is one of the heaviest bands. They're up there with Obituary, just in a completely different style. Oh, just yeah. Really fucking heavy.
Game changers.
Yep.
And for sure, dude.
We hope that you hear a little bit of Meshuggah in or something.
Awesome, dude. Awesome. Well, let's take a listen to this first track from Mastiff's new CD. What is it called again, fellas?
From the Ash of Elders is the CD, and this song is entitled Aphotic.
Well, let's do this shit. We'll be right back. Holy shit, little Meshuggah there. Meshuggahna, little Meshuggahna for ya. You are listening to Ritual Madness Podcast, episode 127, hanging out with Mastiff. Do me a favor, check out ritualmadnesspodcast.com. On the right side, you'll be able to connect with us on iTunes, Stitcher, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Check out the new YouTube channel, which is bullshit because YouTube's a bunch of cunts for fucking... Fuck them.
Fuck them.
Fucking stupid bastards. Do me a favor. Download the Listen to My Radio app. That's L-I-S-T and the number 2, My Radio. Push in the search bar, Ritual Madness Podcast. Be able to connect with us on our radio station here. Running all kinds of national and local, all kinds of good stuff on there. Below that, there's a little Amazon link. Click the Amazon link and bookmark it as your own. Every time you buy something off of Amazon, kicks back a couple pennies at no cost to you. Below there, there's a donation button. And if you're in a band or have friends that are in bands, you want to have us played on the podcast, that'd be great. Ritual Madness Podcast at Gmail. That's Ritual Madness Podcast at Gmail. Do me a favor. Check out DOTWpod.com. That's Disciples of the Watch Podcast. Great fucking podcast.
Mean Gene.
Yes, sir. And check out The Root of All Evil on Fresh Air Radio, KFAI. Very cool radio show that's been going on since the 80s. Rest in peace, Earl. Your birthday was just this last week. And, man, we all miss you here, man. And you are such a staple in this, community. And
definitely
helped us all out getting to where we all are now. And we miss you, buddy. And do us a favor. May 7th at Lee's Liquor Lounge in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Metal de Mayo. That's right. The weekend of Cinco de Mayo. Ritual Madness Podcast is presenting the Metal de Mayo with Mortificator, A Blood War, Sin 7, and Simothwa. Doors are at 8:30.
No
joke. Music should start at 9 o'clock. $2 fucking Jack and Cokes, $3 Tallboy PBRs, $300 worth of tattoo giveaways from Lowbrow Saints, Lowbrow Saints Tattoo Collective in South Minneapolis. Very cool of those guys. And I want to give a big shout out to Capital Guitars for backlining that show. It's going to be great. And we're going to be doing those once a month for the rest of the year. And then hopefully we'll see if we can pick up the pace depending on how many bands jump on board. I know when I put it on Facebook, we had about 85 bands from 3 different states that wanted to get involved. Lots of fucking bands. Back in the late 90s, early 2000s, the Minneapolis scene was booming with so many bands playing at a place called The Quest. And they did a show every Friday night called The Quest for Mayhems. And it started out as once a month, and then it ended up being every fucking Friday, running 2 rooms of all kinds of music. And it was so much fun. And it was like a spot that you knew everybody was going to be at on every Friday night. Nobody booked shows on Friday nights when the Quest for Mayhems were going on. It was just so much fun to get together with everybody. And it was like, you know, everybody was united on a positive front of trying to get this music scene. And there were, you know, American Head Charge was booming really well. Slipknot just got signed from Iowa. I mean, it was just a huge buzz for the music scene in the Midwest. And hopefully with Lee's Liquor Lounge allowing us to do a metal night once a month, it will bring it back to its former glory.
No joke.
Hopefully. I'm hoping. I want to put a lot of different bands and mix.
I want to play there. I want to play.
You do? Yeah, well, we should do that then. We should figure out something. Do you guys don't have anything booked for August, do you?
No.
Then
no.
Keep it open, because then you can play OTM and Gar and Trail
Boss.
Really? Oh, we're there.
Really? Dude. Really?
If you guys
don't put us on there.
We'll open that shit up.
All right. If you guys want to play it, man, I'll definitely put that together. Hell so yeah. That's going to be August 19th, by the way. So.
Oh,
that's a whole lot
there.
Of heavy.
Yep. We're there.
A whole lot of heavy.
Thinking about doing a large Halloween show as well, where we can just get buck wild and everybody can get costumed up. And
when you think of large, think of Mastiff.
Those Quest of Mayhems, they were ridiculous,
yeah,
dude.
They were so much fun.
They were ridiculous.
I think that for Halloween, I'm going as Neil Pruitt with a ball gag.
In a
meat hammock.
Everybody should.
Yeah. Just there's like 12 fucking Neils there.
It's so sexy.
Yeah. It's going to be awesome, dude. You were such a sexy beast back then, dude. I mean, not that you're not a sexy beast right now, but... I'm saying back then you had no shame in your game back then, brother.
I had better hair going then.
You did, didn't you?
Yeah, I had a full head of hair.
He's talking about you.
P pubes. He had that weird runway thing, pube thing.
Going I got a merkin.
Now he's manscaping.
Treasure trail.
Yeah.
Manscape.
Find the heavy.
Oh, that's fucking awesome, man. That's awesome. So, like I said, we're in the studio with Mastiff. I want to say appreciate everybody who's tuning in right now. And for those of you who are downloading this podcast, man, thank you very much for the support. It's fucking great to have people in the scene supporting this deal and keeping things going. And it's great to have good bands come in here and expose your ears to this great music. Like I said, we started with some Obituary. Slowly We Rot. We did what was the song?
Which one?
Our song.
Aphotic.
Oh, Aphotic. Yeah, the master song was Aphotic.
Yep. From your new album. What's your new album called?
From the Ash of Elders.
From the Ass of Elvis.
Yes.
Yes.
Ah, is it too late to change it? Call copycats. See if we can fucking change that shit. I like that
dude,
better.
Just to have them doing the karate stance, dude. It's fucking. I'm sorry, man.
I love it.
It's fucking excellent. And, you know, so you guys got all kinds of shit coming up, man. You guys are going to be on The Root of All Evil playing live next weekend, right?
Correct.
Yeah,
unfortunately. And what'd you say, unfortunately?
Unfortunately, I think, I don't know. I'm way out of practice, so I'm hoping the band does well enough to make up for my shenanigans.
Yeah.
It's not only is it going to be good, it's going to be good enough.
Yeah. So, we got that going for us.
Hell yeah. That's great.
Dude. No, I'm super excited to be on the show. I'm nervous.
So I wanted to ask you guys, since you guys are all experienced musicians in the scene for many years, how do you guys feel about the rumors going around about the pay-to-play shows that are going on right now?
Bullshit.
Yeah, that shit's lame.
Pay-to-play is not worth it unless... I just... Quick 2 cents, and I mean, I've seen Facebook debates go on for fucking pages and days and
well,
whatever.
I wanted to bring it up to you guys because, you know, right now I haven't gotten... Okay, so when this all started to come up, you know, and... the promoter in question, and I won't say anybody's name or the promotions company right at this moment, but everybody knows who it is, and that I was talking to a mutual friend of ours, and we were talking about this specific scenario, and I asked him what are the pros and the cons of both sides, because I sat with Swordlord and he talked about doing that back in the day, and he broke it down like this. He said that he would give bands tickets at a discounted price, and then when the band sold their tickets, he would allow them to keep that what the extra, you know. So if the tickets were, if he's giving them to you for 15 and you're selling them for 20 and he's selling them, you know, through
his,
he
lets you keep $5,
he lets
ticket.
You keep that money, right? And you're actually making money.
Decker
off
had
of it.
Done that before.
Yep, Decker yeah. done that before. And my thing is, and when I talked to our mutual friend, I said, you know, what are the pros and cons? Because none of the bands are actually talking about it. They're saying, yeah, we're getting a chance to open for these bands. We're getting a chance to do this. And I had Endless Rain on here, and we talked about the fact that this promoter is digging so far deep into the bucket of bands that basically, if you think about it, okay, so my band, your band, Kevin's band, Neil's band, Aaron's band, and Aaron Ryan's band are all playing the same fucking show, okay? And normally, if Al's band and my band are playing, the rest of you guys would buy tickets from one of us, right?
Right.
So
anyway.
So when you have, you know, 20 bands or 15 bands on a bill, you got, you know, five of them on the main stage with the headliners, and then you have the other 10 in this small room that really nobody's going to check out. Yeah. You know what I mean? But
people are purposely showing up late for...
But the ticket pool and the fact that now you're eating the cost, and this is what I didn't understand about it. So the pros are is that you're getting the possibility to have more publicity, and people are maybe going to see your band.
Get your name on a bill.
Yep, get your name on a bill.
The pro is, yeah, you're not really anybody, but you're getting to play a show with the national act.
Yeah.
The con is, well, you got other bands from the same area.
Let me finish my thought, ahead. And then I'll let you guys chime out on this, because it's something that I want to get out here, because it to me it is that this promoter, I think, is digging into the band pool so much that it's hurting the band's trying to sell those tickets that they're not going to be able to sell the tickets, okay? Now, from what I understand, that the promoter is actually giving them a small percentage of, it's not the $5 like Sword Lord or Decker or anybody else back in the day would give. It is a small percentage of those tickets if they sell all of those tickets, okay? So that's what I don't understand. And another thing I don't understand is, okay, so if you give me 20 tickets and I only sell 5 of those tickets, do I still get to play the show? Are you now going to blackball me to not allow me to play in that Studio B or that small room? Am I not going to be able to play those? And I think that as he's digging into this pool, it's hurting our scene, because not only are these bands not able to sell those tickets to their friends, so Alan, my band and Al's band are in the run for playing the show. We're both selling 20 tickets, and now we have 4 other guys that we can sell those tickets to. Now, if all of our bands are on this bill, we don't have anybody to sell those tickets to, so what the fuck happens here? Now, I talked to a guy the other weekend who's telling me that this promoter, now this is all allegation, I don't know, and I'm going to have this promoter on my show to ask him these particular questions, but my dilemma is that now I'm hearing that he is not only saying, okay, you've got to sell 100 tickets to be on Totally Awesome Fest, right? You got to sell 100 tickets to be on the main stage. You got to sell 50 to be on the small stage, right? So if you don't sell all those tickets, now this is just allegation, and what I've heard is that you have to cover the rest of those tickets if you don't sell them.
That's horrible.
That, yeah, right there, that's what it is. It makes no sense to me.
Well, what it is about? Is they want to play a show with the National Act, and they're not going to sell it because they're on a show with...
Dude, there's 15 other bands that are in the beer room.
And they're all the same bands pretty much.
Now that crushes your chance to sell those tickets to those other people.
You're not going to, because I'm friends with this friend, right? And that friend, exactly. And this friend.
You're making bands compete against each other when you should be coming together and doing it all as one.
Exactly. Now
that's what sucks.
Here's the thing. Now this is me to complete the thought, and now we can have a discussion about it. But as a complete thought, back in the day, now we've all been in the scene close to 20 years or more. Okay? So back in the day, you would pay your dues. You would play these shows, you would make a name for yourself, and then a promoter who's doing these big shows would hear about your band from somebody else. They would be working with, Brian from Cold Colors, or they'd be working with, multiple people in the scene and go, who out of all these bands out here are drawing right now? Exactly. Who are the bands that have made themselves? So you're moving from us from a D level to a C level to a B level to an A level, American Head Charge, Nuisance. In my opinion, these are the guys who draw right now. What I'm saying is that all of us have experienced this, to where each one of our bands has made a name for ourselves and have been offered the right to get up there and get that publicity. You know what I'm saying? You have made it enough to move from D to C to B, and now you're being offered a show to play with these national bands. To me, and this is my opinion, this is all allegation, this is all rumor at this particular time, because I'm hearing it from multiple people sticking up for this promoter, people saying this, people saying that. Granted, he has to cover his costs. I totally understand that. But what I'm saying is, do these fucking bands who are getting offered these shows and giving the chance to sell these tickets, in my opinion, these bands have not moved up the ladder to where they should be even offered the chance to play. There should be 5 or 6 bands in that side B. And those 5, 6 bands should be bands that have drawn consistently and have good followings, right? And the ones that are opening for these national acts should be bands that are drawing consistently, that are going to help sell this fucking show. Because he's obviously... In my opinion, now this is just my opinion, I have nothing against this promoter or his shows, because he's bringing some great fucking music here, and he's doing great things for the music to come here, but he's crushing the bands like us that are out here busting our ass to try to do something. The scene right now is hurting because of the fact that there is nobody going to shows. They can watch your videos on YouTube. They can fucking download your album. The Mastiff album comes out in a month, you know what I mean? At the end of this month or the middle of this month, correct?
Yep.
So it comes out. Who says that somebody's not going to fucking torrent that shit and your shit is out on the online? I was just told just the other day that I got your full OTM CD for free online. And I was like, what? I go, dude, we hardly sold. And I don't mind. I don't give a fuck. I don't care if you bootleg it, you download it, you're listening to it. But for me, this is the thing, is that promoters and people out there that are crushing our scene right now, because we're not getting people to show up at the shows where they need to be. Back in the day, from the late 90s to the middle 2000s, where all of us were playing these big shows, we were getting offered these big shows. We were getting a chance to display what we fucking love to do, man. What we put our time and effort in. 20 years, yep. We've all been doing this shit, man. And we've got people that come in here and fuck everything up for us. You know, and it fucking boggles my motherfucking mind, dude. It infuriates me because I hear...
It's mind-boggling.
Yeah.
I want to get the whole story between... all the bands that are doing this stuff. And I want to know what are they thinking? What is the thought behind it? Okay, you want to open for these great shows, but at the same time, do you realize that you're fucking yourself in the ass, man?
Yeah.
And everybody just sees, they think about themselves and they just want to get up there and they want to play it.
They want to pay.
We're on one of those bills. We're on Prong. You know? Yep. I don't know if we have to sell tickets. Do we have to sell tickets for that?
It's expected that we sell some tickets.
But we were on the bill before that promoter took over.
I should be seeing those tickets in the mail any day now. Other bands have gotten their tickets already, so mine should be
here.
I was assured that our tickets are.
I don't even know.
And here it is, guys. I'm not seeing any names. And people who know this scene, they know who I'm talking about. And I promote every one of the guys' shows, and I have been for the last 3 years. And I have absolutely, you know, I want to promote the shit that's coming to town, but I'm having a battle within myself to think, okay, man, you know, this is great. You're bringing all these nationals in town, but you're fucking all the young ones. And I don't want you guys to feel like you're being pressured to speak against or for this particular promoter. But at the same time, it's mind boggling.
It's a touchy subject.
It's like getting your mind all wrapped up in a bottle.
Yeah,
it really is. I actually have a not a strong opinion, but I have a definite opinion.
Please.
That I'd love to retort. Not retort. I'm not sure if that's the right word.
Yes.
But so back in our day.
Yeah. Back in the day.
Old's back in all of our day. Anybody old? as you said, it was more cut and dry back in the day. Yep. And it was, as you said, has your band done shit? Do people come to your shows, and is it more than just the idiots from your fucking high school?
Did you earn it?
Yeah, did you earn it? And that's how it was back then. And certain bands pulled it off, and certain bands didn't. If you were a garage band, if you were sloppy, you know, ticket sales didn't matter as much. You had to kind of do both. Nowadays, it seems to me, now we're going way more into my philosophy here, which is probably fucking horrible.
Nope.
It seems like there's more tiers of pay to play, or different, just like there's genres of metal, there's different forms of pay to play. Now, We Are Legion, Neil and I's other band. We played a show, and this is an example when this subject comes up a lot. It is an example that I use a lot. We had already been, as a band, against pay to play, quote unquote, okay,
sure.
as a whole or in general, okay. However, we were offered a show with Vital Remains at the Triple Rock,
right?
Okay, and the only requirement was to sell, I don't know, an easy number of tickets.
Sure.
It wasn't something ungodly or ridiculous. And I think we did have to pay to get those tickets, okay.
So you had to pay in advance for your
tickets. We had to pay in advance for our tickets. However, us as a band, opening for Vital Remains, which at the time had not been here all that many times.
Sure.
They had been here, but not that many.
Sure.
Us as a band feeling we don't think we're the greatest, but, you know, hey, we do okay, and we got some people that come to every fucking show.
Right.
We felt like we could sell enough tickets, okay? We ended up profiting $250 playing with Vital Remains, okay? That was an easy give and pay to play. Yes, we had to pay in order to play, but it was a smart decision on our part. What I think, to kind of jump back into what you were saying with current bands and shit like that, is not a lot of bands locally think about the shows that they're paying to play for.
Right.
Is it worthwhile? Are you ready for it? Are you going to go up there and make an ass of yourself?
Right.
Are you on this show because mom and dad gave you money?
That's exactly what it is.
And for this certain dude we're probably talking about, and other promoters like himself that have the same philosophy, sometimes you're putting really fucking shitty bands on shows
that may not even match the fucking the genre. You know what I mean?
There's so many Joe Schmoes out there, Joe Schmo, young kid metalheads that only go to nationals, that either don't know about the local scene, quote unquote, or they know of it and they just have no interest or haven't gotten that far yet or whatever the case. They go to these shows and they see this such and such band that had the money to get on the show that fucking suck. What are those people going to think of the local metal scene? And that's where my opinion divides. Pay to play is now currently many tiers, I think, and there's even more that I could branch off into that I won't.
Sure.
But it can be okay for your band, it can be smart for your band, and it can be really fucking stupid for your band.
Right.
As a promoter, you can do it well, you can do it right, and I think some locals have.
Yeah.
And you can also really fuck it up.
Right. Right. Oh.
I got to see that.
Tear the fucking house down.
So that's my two cents. Yeah. I don't have a strong opinion either way. I've seen both sides of the coin.
Sure.
I've seen a really horrible, and yes, it's gotten much worse. And it fucking sucks. But if all we can do is the granddads is say, hey kids, hey, think about it. I mean, open our mouths sometimes.
Right.
And if we see it on Facebook, whatever the fuck, if you're at a show, oh, we've got this great show, we're opening for, you know, say something. I don't know, however you want to say it.
I don't, you know, here's the thing, is I totally understand, and this is the thing, is I see where these promoters are coming from. I understand that they have a lot of costs, a lot of promotion costs, they have a lot of things, you know, Swordlord said it the best, because he said, you know, there's permits that you have to get, there's catering you have to get, there's fucking contracts that you have to fulfill, and you never know if you're gonna win or lose on a lot of these shows, and you have to cover your cost. I get that. But if you're not giving a percentage, or you're penalizing somebody, or condemning them for not being able to step up, I mean, these are bands, like you said, are they to that capability of doing that? Are they understanding the fact that yeah, you can play with American Head Charge. Yes, you can play with Motor Grader. You can play with Ministry. You can play with these bands. That's great to be on the bill and say, I played on a bill. I can say I played on a bill with Stone Temple Pilots. I can say that
I
played.
Belong up there?
You know, exactly. But here's the thing. Nickelback, I played with those guys too. You know what I mean? It's like,
right.
Here's the fucking, the fact of the matter though, is it really gonna help your band? If you can't, I mean, you're gonna be penalized for it.
Right.
You're stepping on your own dick. You're basically, you know, and what people are failing to see is that they are setting themselves up to fail, and that's the worst thing about it.
Yes.
And now think about it as a young musician, when you're trying to get out there and you're trying to hone your skills and you're trying to become a better band and you're trying to be not sloppy and you're trying to be, I mean, you guys can all relate to this, man. We've been in this shit for a long fucking time.
I gotta
time,
say,
man.
When I was fucking horrible in a horrible band, if I was offered an awesome slot with an awesome national that we had no business on,
right.
Fuck yeah, I would have. Yeah, let's do take it. Let's yeah. open for someone.
Yeah,
for,
and you know, you got to think about that
no,
too.
Don't.
As, you know, like you said, with your friends from high school and all those things and those people, you're the first time that they've ever been in contact with a real band, guys who really took and tried to hone their craft and learn an instrument and do something. So these guys are blowing fucking smoke up your ass constantly. So you start to believe that you're better than you actually are. And then you get people, you know what I mean? You get people out there.
Mastiff's whole problem.
Yeah. No shit.
There you go.
And again, I'm not trying to shit on this promoter. I'm really not trying to shit on the promoter or what he's trying to do for music in general. I just think that he's setting a lot of people up to fail.
I really need, can I interject
Absolutely.
One thing too before I forget, because I will, and it's specifically off of something that you brought up, which is that promoters have to cover their costs, and they have to cover their ass, and they got to do it some way. And this is ignorant speaking, okay, because I'm not a promoter, and I'm, even to this day, after all this time in the metal scene, I still don't know 100% how they work. I feel like if a promoter can't afford to support the show themselves,
he shouldn't fucking do the show.
He shouldn't book the show. It should not be up to local bands to sell so many tickets,
right.
Or they're, as you said, punished in some way, shape, or form, whatever
right.
form of
right.
vocabulary you want right. to use for that. It either the promoter can afford it or he can't. One time I got to afford it to bring Abigail Williams to Triple Rock. It was one of the greatest booking achievements of my life, but if it failed, I had the money to pay for every band.
Right.
But that was the only way I was doing
it. You know, and that's a lot of promoters big downfall. They overextend themselves so much, and they don't have the network to get it out there for them to make any money or to cover their costs. So then you hear about these stories where people are just running out and they're fucking shitting, and then guys like you who are trying to get Abigail Williams or any other band that are any tier of national, you know, you get a bad fucking rap. A guy who wants to put I would love to down the road get some national acts, but if their management doesn't know you or you don't have a rapport with those people, you're never going to get those. If right. It's not a big club,
they're smart. They've been there before.
Yeah, if it's not a big club that's going to cover those costs and make sure that they sign that contract and have that guarantee right up front, they're not going to fucking do it, and that's what sucks. And then you get guys that can do that. And here's the thing that I think gets lost in translation when it comes to being a promoter, okay? A promoter is supposed to promote the fucking show. Not just throw the show, promote the show, okay? You do radio ads.
Not rely on
you
the bands.
You do city pages. You do, you know, ads in different spots, and you make radio fucking commercials. You do this stuff. You spend the money to promote. Not rely.
Like everybody advertises the show, but the promoter should be promoting.
If you rely on the bands, all you're getting is Facebook.
Yeah, nowadays,
that's all the bands promote is Facebook.
Nowadays,
we just use MySpace still. MySpace, so I mean, you're fucked if you have us on a show.
I just got my MySpace account back again after years and years of fucking not.
We should all go back.
I looked at it a couple months ago, and it just looked so foreign to me.
Dude, I was so skinny.
I jumped right off. I was like, I don't understand.
I was so fucking skinny back then, dude. It's like I'm standing next to my motorcycle going, God damn, I was sexy, man. Look at me now. I got man boobs and fucking hairy-ass gray beard and shit, man. It's crazy. So, I mean, let's go around the table. How do you guys feel about, in general, Al, you kind of spoke about, how you're feeling about it.
Yeah, that's my two cents. I think you can be smart about it or you can be stupid about it, I think.
How about you, Kevin?
If you get offered pay to play, think about it. Ask questions.
Yeah, I kind of feel the same way Al does. It depends on the situation.
Right.
You know,
would be your optimal situation when it comes to if someone asked you to do that and said, well, here, this is what you got to cover this cost? And
well, not 14 local bands on the bill, obviously, so sell the tickets.
Right.
And then not a huge amount of tickets to sell either.
Right. Yeah.
Depends on the band, the venue. So many factors go into play. Like, you know, we got to be smart about it. Is this something that's going to work for us?
Yeah.
Or is it something that's going to, you know, bite us in the butt?
Right. Absolutely. Yeah.
You got to take it as a case by case.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely, man. How about you, Neil? What do you think about that?
I don't know, man. I don't really like talking about the money part of it when it comes to the shows. I just like showing up and playing. Man.
Yeah, exactly, man. And you got to think about that. There. And this is how it is in every fucking band. There's always one guy. You know, you want to be diplomatic about the decisions you make in a band. And anybody listening, as far as it goes, I mean, each one of us has been in the scene for so long that every band that we've been in, either we've been that guy who's the dictator out of the diplomat, you know what I mean? Like, everybody wants to be diplomatic about the decisions, but there's always one guy that says, okay, we're going to book the show. We're going to get these bands on it, okay? Oh, yeah. Or yes, we'll play with these particular bands, you know? We can't all just be like, we're going to go there and fucking do our thing, you know, which really sucks because this is what we love to do, man. We love to get together, have some drinks, talk shit, fucking, you know, puff a little bit, fucking make some good music and expose.
Same with our friends. Yeah.
You know, yeah, man. Expose it to people. And then, you know, when you get your friends in the room together and you get to throw down and you have a good time with everything, that is what we all want to fucking do, man. And I just feel like it's becoming something so fucking more business oriented than it needs to be right now. You know, it's not fun anymore, man. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, obviously it is. It's still fun. We're doing it, obviously. Yeah. But it's becoming more hectic and more crazy these days, man. You know, you got to think about all this fucking shit. And you got to, you know, it's not like when we were kids, man. We'll just fucking go up there and throw it down. You know, it's fucking.
Yeah.
Aaron, what do you think about the whole pay to play deal?
I don't know. I'm old school, and like I said before, you had to earn it. Like I remember my shows that I played with, you know, with national acts. I mean, I played when I was with Avalanche. we played with Overkill at the Mirage, which don't exist anymore. Sure. But I mean, the bands that played, it was Porcelain God, Avalanche, and Overkill. And at the time, those two bands were like the biggest drawing bands, period.
Yeah.
I mean, we would play Ryan's Corner and it would just be packed. 250 people on a Friday night. And it's just, you know.
Fucking even on a weekday, dude. You know, if you get the
Thursday night, we'd play like Thursday night at Ryan's, would have like a free beer night. You pay the cover charge. And
sure.
It's just the day and age, the internet and everything, you know. It's just, and then you look at it, and then you get like, there's a lot of younger bands, you know, they're good bands and stuff, but you start seeing a lot of these younger bands, like, playing with these national acts, and it's, you know, they're fucking paying to play.
Sure.
And it's like, how much are they eating? How much are they actually selling?
Right.
And then, obviously, with the promoter, are they cool? Like, did they sell enough tickets, or did they cover the cost? And then, like, you know, the promoter's like, well, they're a cool band. They covered the cost on their thing. I'm going to just put them on there. You know, they're a pretty decent band.
Right.
I mean, like Al said, there's different tiers of pay to play.
You know, it blows me away because I think, you know, there's bands in this scene that could easily be on. I mean, here's the thing is that back in the day, you played locally and maybe, you know, Duluth or La Crosse or Eau Claire or, you know what I mean? There were a handful of spots to play around here. Now bands like Reaping and fucking Witch Den and, you know, I mean, there's a shitload of bands that jump in their van and they go on a fucking tour. Yep. Bludgeon, you know? Mm. Bludgeon is a band.
Invidiosis.
They're going to South America. They're doing fucking, you know, they're doing great things. To me, man, how many times can you say, I'm going to jump in my van and fucking take off on tour? And you hear about these bands.
Zero.
That now are buying onto these big packages. You got to wonder, like, man, are you even making your money back? Are you getting your name out there? Are you able to continue having enough shirts and CDs and shit when you're out on the road, man? Because these bands are getting fucking, you know, boxes of shirts and CDs sent to them to the next gig each time, you know what I mean, to cover their shit. I can't imagine being a touring band going out there and not having merch.
And then the fucking clubs take, what, 10, 15, 20%?
Now, they're starting to do that shit a lot.
And just now are bands starting to speak out
about it.
More so. Yeah. I mean, it's always been a thing, but I've heard it for many years from touring bands. But, I mean, bands like Behemoth and I forget who else, a couple other bands are really starting to, you know, say, hey, it's enough. This is only place we make money now.
Remember when we fucking used to get t-shirts for fucking, you know, 15, 20 bucks, and now they're like in their fucking 40s and 50s.
25 and 30s for a one-sided, two-color.
Yeah, man. Yeah, dude. You know, and you can't, I don't know, I'm a fat fucker, so, when you know, Goat Whore is one of those bands that always comes through for me when they come to town. They always got fat cat sizes, and I always tell Ben, dude, you always come through
for
me,
and the prices are always good with them. I think part of their strategy, though, is they keep the colors down.
Yeah.
They keep it just a few colors, but they do it really fucking well.
Yeah. Great artwork.
My fiance's got a hoodie from them. It's like two or three colors, but it's just like, it's still vivid and full of design.
Cool
and just
shit.
Badass. Yeah, yeah, they're smart.
Fuck yeah, man. Fuck yeah. So how was it? How are you guys building this up as you're getting ready to release the CD? When is your release show? You guys gonna prop that bad boy up? What's the date on that one?
April 15th.
So a couple of weeks away. April 15th. Where's it at?
Club Underground.
Club Underwears?
Club Underpants.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
One of my all-time favorite places to play.
It's
absolute top five for sure in history.
Yeah. It's better when Jordan's doing sound.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, I love it.
Love it.
Yeah. Jordan makes it. From the very beginning when he started doing sound there, he really made that fucking room come alive, dude. I
was shocked when I did a couple of videos for a couple of bands there, and I got really good audio from the audio recorder.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure what my ears heard. I was pretty shit-faced.
Dude, he does it with minimal fucking material, too. You know what I mean? That's what's great about it, is that he works really well with the room and puts it all together. And
I love that club. It's like mm-hmm. some dude that likes metal turned his basement into a club.
Hell yeah, like the Doom Room.
Yeah. It's. I love it. I'm so excited to have her CD release party.
And you know what's great is that they've really opened their fucking doors for our underground scene as well.
Man. Absolutely.
You know, Josh and the people at the underground have really fucking adapted our scene for. You know, as their own, you know, and they love it when we all come there too, you know, that they know that there's not going to be a big fucking brawl and, you know, shit getting broken. It's like, we take care of the place pretty fucking good.
We have fun, but, yeah, we keep it nice.
We keep it crunk. We keep it on fleek and shit. Totally out of fucking character there. But yeah, man. So who else is playing on that bill?
We have Gar, Cantherone. Who else do we have on there? Gorgatron from Nodak.
Oh, shit.
Glutton for Punishment.
Label mates and good buddies of ours. Some awesome local death metal. It'll be one of their first few shows with their new drummer, Ogar.
Oh, yeah.
From Acanthostega. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yep. And Compulsive Mutilation.
Face of Oblivion.
Face of Oblivion. Badass drummer.
The Blastmaster.
Yep. Now, you guys have... that band, or that... The label mix. Now, you guys are doing a dual release on this one, too, right?
Yeah.
So it's going to be Zero Budget and Twin Town Tyrants.
Yes, correct.
Now, what made you guys... Now, I know that you're in a band with Will,
yes.
And he basically runs and operates Zero Budget. How did you guys decide to do a split?
Greed.
See how much money we could pay for out of both of them. Absolute greed.
Honestly... And it's no secret to either one of the labels. I'm sure they knew what my plan was. I've been friends with Will for a long time, and I've been in We Are Legion for a long time. I've been on Zero Budget Records for a long time.
Yep.
They've been a great independent label to us, and I've never had any kind of complaints.
Right.
And then Twin Town Tyrant Records came along and started putting out some really fucking awesome recordings, awesome releases. And when it came to Mastiff, I was like, you know, who do we approach?
Ultimately... The idea came from Aaron Whitesides,
right?
Because I was talking to him about, you know, we're making an album, and then he was like, "Well, why don't you talk to Rob and get on Twin Town too?" And I was like, "Well, can you be on two labels?" He's like, "Why the fuck not?"
Like, doesn't hurt to ask, man.
It's not like it's back in the old days where you sign a specific contract. Yeah, you know? You sign a specific contract with one particular label.
No.
I think it's so cool that both of the labels are working hand in hand because they're recording, you know, at 1459 and doing all that stuff, and everybody's, you know, sharing and uniting and helping with this underground scene, man. It's fucking beautiful.
And both labels are helping, you know, with what they can. I mean, they're both a Zero Budget Record type of label, both of them, regardless of the namesake. So, you know, they're not exactly putting us on tour in Europe. They're independent labels, but they're both helping us in different ways that each of them specialize in.
Right.
And we're cross-promoting both labels equally and trying to give them as much promotion as we can. Mm-hmm. And Zero Budget not being primarily a metal label, you know, we're trying to bring some... We got a rock and roll side, if you hear the entire CD, you know, a little bit of that. And so then we got, you know, the more of them are heavier side for the Twin Town Tyrant crowd. So we just felt like it was a good, you know, a good mix, a good family to try out.
Yeah.
And we all somehow convinced them of the same, and they said okay.
And who better to be ambassadors of both labels than us?
Right? Because we don't know what
that's the way I look at it.
Guys,
come on, I'm trying to, you know. What the hell?
No, it's been going good so far. It's been going really good so far. It's kind of scary, but...
Well, like you said, we were talking outside, and you know, you said with the podcast and everything that it's kind of all fallen into place with everything. You guys got a drummer, and you got things rolling, and you guys are recording and, you know, writing and recording and getting things together, and you know, you're kind of doing a little bit of a circuit and getting things out there, and it seems to be falling into place, man. Nobody can ask for more than that, man.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, this is as far as, you know, a longtime local metal musician. Or dude in a band, whatever you want to call a vocalist. this is the most fun for me right here. I'm done tracking, done recording, done mixing, done mastering. This is the fun part for us. So this is super exciting. We're on an awesome kick-ass fucking show, and you know, having some drinks with buds, talking about our new CD. I mean, this is it. This is a pinnacle for us.
Get better than this.
Yeah,
it could get better than this. We can.
If it does, it's all bonus. From here, we're happy. So
bonus.
A few people like it, we're cool with it.
Yeah, man. Boners. All good boners. Boners are good. It gets things done. That's how we're all here. It's from boners. You know that, right?
Boners have their time and place, though.
You know, I never looked.
I mean, that's what we're all from. Even if they go to the left and then to the right.
Even up against a window when a family's passing along.
So, I mean, dude, so the CD release sounds like it's going to be fucking badass. Great lineup.
Ideal. I was very, what do you call it? Selfish. I was selfish when we came up with that. What bands do we want to play with the right. most? We didn't care who drew the most or who was hot or whatever.
Or who was going to pay to play.
Most attractive.
Who was going to pay us to play.
Yeah, and we were going to do a pay to play, you know, in order to play with Mastiff.
I seriously still get starstruck when I see other bands play.
Yeah.
Whether they're local or...
All these bands are bands that we look up to.
Yeah. Each one of the bands on that on your show is fucking, they're amazing.
They're all, I mean, I can't wait to watch them, you know, let alone play the show.
Dude, I just watched Cantherone at the Hexagon, dude.
Yeah.
And that bass player, dude, he was fucking doing this fucking, just following.
Oh, he feels
dude,
it.
Dude, so Every much, dude. I was Every blown away. I'm just standing there going, what the fuck, man?
Jake's
Yeah, first time we saw it, me and Kevin saw him at Minnesota Music Cafe, and we were just like, who the fuck are these guys? Dude. They're fucking badass.
They're great, man. They're great.
We saw them. We knew right away. And we did get to play a show with them at that basement.
So Gooch says to me, he goes, have you seen these guys live yet? He goes, I got to see them and they did a Clutch cover. So the first time I got to see them live, I go, guys playing Clutch tonight? And they all look at me and they're like, no, we didn't plan on it. I go, you should probably play some Clutch tonight. They're like, well, I mean, it's a pretty straightforward song, and they're all like, we really love Clutch, you know, sort of that to underground. And I go, fucking Clutch, play some Clutch. All right, we're gonna play Burning Beard by Clutch, you know. They fucking busted out a fucking,
I was wondering what you're,
dude, it was excellent. Really? Excellent. Yeah, they fucking tore
imagine.
It up, dude.
Yeah, the Anderson brothers, like, they're cool guys, man. Yeah, they're very cool
beer
guys.
Drinking fucking maniacs, dude. Right. They're fucking Viking beer drinkers, right? Yeah, there, man.
Let me point out too, one of my personal favorites on the bill, Gar. They've got a full length CD out right now that is, it goes into a list with Grand Demise of Civilization, a highly underrated
black metal
entire
band.
I mean CD in general. This is a CD that many people should check out, beginning to end. The Gar CD is just some unreal, straightforward Pantera type groove heaviness.
Yeah. Grindy at times too, man.
They got some dirty grinds in there.
Dude, that video they released was fucking ridiculous, dude. I watched that and went, I want one like that.
Right.
Yeah. Like, holy fuck, man.
Our plan is we're gonna cut the audio from that and we're gonna put a Mastiff song underneath it. It's gonna look a lot, it'll be in black and white though.
So, we'll use lots of chocolate syrup.
Yeah, they can't get us for it.
So it's, what is that called? Artistic
artistic interpretation.
Yeah, there it is.
I'll cut 1.5 seconds out of every minute.
Every reel, yeah. It's like, just play it backwards. Do the video backwards and shit.
There you go.
To a Mastiff tune, that'd be good.
Totally
shit,
different, dude.
Yeah. Well, let's play some more music, man. We've got another Mastiff tune, another debut Mastiff tune off their new album, Ashes from Elvis's Behind. Ashes from Elvis.
Number one worldwide.
Ashes of the Elders.
From the Ash of Elders.
There you go. From the
Ass of Elvis.
It's the best ever, dude. And this one is which one is this one?
White
is
Raven, I think.
Is this White Raven?
Okay, what's this one about?
This would be White Raven. This song's kind of about being the outcast, you know, being the freak, being very, 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 very different. What other people might consider a freak, but, you know, more of
we
the...
We embrace that shit.
Yeah. Definitely stand out, be different, embrace the differences type of thing, and overcoming that type of shit and rising above it, even above and beyond overcoming.
So this one's, like, dedicated to Steve Wolf.
For when he stands up. No, yeah, and actually, it's what inspired me is actually Neil's son, Phoenix. And I mentioned him in the lyrics there. He's an autistic kid, but he's in our video, We Are Legion video, The Plague Becomes. He knows, like, more of the lyrics than I do. I forget this shit all the time. And
You fucked up.
He's so enthusiastic about music and metal. And it's like, you know, for, you know, the way that some people talk about autism, should meet this kid. Yeah. And he really inspired me to write the song. I mean, really.
Sounds like Metal Pete from Burial Ritual.
Very much so. Yeah. Great example. That dude's fucking awesome. I've had hour-long conversations with him.
When I first met him, I
so
was like,
cool to talk
holy
to.
Oddball. Like, whoa, who the fuck is this dude? He plays in Burial Ritual? And then they, dude, when they started.
And an awesome drummer.
Oh, my God, dude. I was awesome like, drummer. Holy fuck. Talk about embracing the instrument, man. This dude's fucking threw down, man.
And these
amazing.
These people don't, you know, seem normal to the average person. I think they're just seeing shit in a way we will never get to.
Never, dude, no.
That we could only hope to see things.
Yeah.
And I'm envious of that. And,
dude, me
and when
too.
I have conversations with this kid, I'm just like in awe. And Jackson, my fiance's even like, why is your mouth hanging open? Because I'm just listening to this kid talk about music,
right?
It, with more depth and feeling than right. I ever did. Right. You know, that's what the song is.
It reminds me of like you see a cat. You know what I mean? Like a cat hears things and sees things that we don't ever. You know, they always say that
it's a good analogy.
They can see the spirit side of it. You know what I'm saying? Like I believe that they seriously focus on things that we. It's like. We only use a part of our brain, you know what I mean? And they use a different part of their brain. And the way they look at it, the outlook of how they interpret everything that we take for granted even, you know what I mean?
Even our own music, to sit and, because he comes to practices sometimes, and to sit and talk to Phoenix about our own songs,
right.
His view of certain songs and why he likes certain songs, I'm just like,
I like what you say about it.
Yeah.
The kid knows my bass lines better than I do.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yeah, it's cool.
God, that's fucking.
So that's White Raven. White Raven is in, and it's taken from something semi-factual or fictional. I don't know if it's true or not. I've seen it debunked or whatever. But the idea is that a white raven is shunned from its family, shunned from its parents.
Right.
You know, and if they survive, they survive alone for the rest of their life.
Right.
But they survive.
Right.
And that's kind of
stronger,
that was the original,
stronger than all of them anyways.
Right.
You know what
stronger
I mean?
Than all. That's right.
And then after that, we've got some Entombed Wolverine Blues taking it back again.
OG Death Rock.
Yes, sir. That's fucking, that is the true definition of that OG Death Rock right there. And then we got some Slayer after that, some War Ensemble. Did any of you guys end up making it to the Slayer show?
I did.
I did not.
Was
that
it
was the
ridiculous?
Second time I missed Slayer in my life.
Was it ridiculous? Awesome. Overpacked?
It was overpacked.
Very overpacked. I mean, you had to been like either on the floor or on the railing or to see anything. Ugh. I mean, I got lucky. I know my way around those freaking concert halls.
I got lucky.
That place. I know where to go. Yeah. So
well, that's good. You lucked out.
They got a good handicap section. That's all.
Yeah,
I say.
I usually,
everybody hang out with.
I hung
with
out
Limo.
With Limo at Machine Head.
Excuse me, sir. You're not supposed to be in here. I'm with him.
I'm with
what
Limo.
What the fuck's wrong with you? I'm with
He's
him.
He's got my spare leg.
I gotta hold him up because he can't lean on his one leg. So I gotta stay right with him.
Yeah,
it's cool. And we smoke weed. It's natural. It's pain.
For the pain.
Yeah, it's a natural analgesic. So we got some Gojira after that. Who picked out the Gojira?
I think all of us.
Yeah. Cody, your
we all love a Gojira.
That was another universal decision.
This is Limo's
universal decision. That's perfect for fucking Gojira.
I think I saw
too.
That porn once.
We all love Gojira.
Probably universal
so much.
Yeah. Gojira is definitely, and I've already said it a few times, but I'm going to say it again. Hoping that you probably, or thinking you will probably hear some Gojira in our sound here and there. We dig how they kind of just take parts and go on them for a while, and they're epic. And
can't wait for that new album to drop.
Yeah.
I heard 78 seconds of it. It was great.
Oh, dude, I can imagine. I can imagine it's going to be.
Did you hear that one with Frederick Thorndahl and dude from Strapping Young Lad?
Yes.
Gene Hoglett.
Devin Townsend.
Yes. Oh, Devin Townsend.
It's insane.
That was fucking nuts.
I know.
I can't wait.
Is that going to be on the CD? I don't even know where the...
I don't know.
I think that was older.
Is it?
Some older stuff.
Yeah, that was on their EP, I believe.
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus.
Old day.
We're getting technical up in here.
Yeah. No.
All right, so we're going to listen to some White Raven. Hopefully you fuckers are bootlegging this right now so you can listen to it many times over before their show April, what is it, 19th?
15th. April 15th.
April 15th.
This is the second full track you will be hearing off the full-length CD from the Ash of Elders on Zero Budget Records and Twin Town Tyrant Records. You will not get to hear this again until the CD comes out.
Fucking A. Awesome. Well, let's take a listen, folks, and we'll be back. Yes, yes, yes. Don't forget to check out that Spring Bash. If you could make it, it's fucking amazing. Milwaukee show from the NYDM. Every year we do this Spring Bash, and it is just getting crazier and crazier every year. 2 or 3 days of just serious drinking and hanging out and listening to fucking serious metal. It's a blast for everybody, man, and hopefully folks can make it out there. Very, very cool. Do me a favor, check out ritualmadnesspodcast.com. On the right side, you can connect with us on a multitude of links, iTunes and Stitcher, Facebook and Twitter, Instagram, YouTube channel. And do me a favor, download the Listen to My Radio app. That's LISTEN, the number 2, My Radio. And put to Ritual Madness Podcast in the search bar. You can listen to our station on your phone, on the go. You can listen to all kinds of shit. We got punk rock, fucking heavy metal, black metal, fucking all those metals that are different colors. And a bunch of rap, all kinds of fucking comedy, all kinds of good stuff. Do me a favor, if you're in a band or have friends that are in bands, send your stuff to ritualmadnesspodcast@gmail. That's ritualmadnesspodcast@gmail. Again, check out dotwpod.com. That's the Disciples of the Watch podcast. Also, a great radio show that is Sunday morning, Saturday evening, Sunday mornings, The Root of All Evil on KFAI Fresh Air Radio. Like I said, it's been around since the 80s. They play some great music, and Mastiff will be on The Root of All Evil next weekend. Sunday, Saturday morning, Sunday morning.
Live.
Playing some of this new stuff. Off of Ashes from the Elvis's Behind. Or whatever.
I'll be lip syncing.
That's awesome, dude. You
FYI.
That's great, dude. Are you just going to play the track and let it rip, huh?
Yeah.
That's killer, dude.
Well, no, the band will be doing their shit because they're all competent musicians, but the vocal tracks will all be.
Just have Neil's son come in and sing.
We'll have the attitude going.
ringer. We got a ringer. Yep. I got a plan.
Yes, absolutely, man. So, again, your CD release show is April 15th at the Club Underpants, a.k.a. the Spring Street over in Northeast Minneapolis off of, what is that? Hennepin? Monroe. No, that's Central in Monroe, right?
Monroe.
Yep.
Great Tots.
Great Tots.
Great Tots. Good burgers. Great Tots.
Yeah, they got good food there, man.
Good food.
Good bartenders, man. Really cool staff. Fucking great spot to catch an underground show, man. And what a better time to show up at Club Underpants than to go see Mastiff CD release. You've got Canthrone on there, some Gar, Glutton for Punishment, the G-Tron boys from fucking Nodak. And, yeah. So are you guys headlining that show, or are you guys doing the before the headlining?
We choose to think of it more as closing.
closing her down.
We're closing that show out, so all the headliners are the bands before us.
Yeah, there you go. Makes sense.
It's same with Legion. We don't like to headline or play last. We want to be somewhere in the beginning, but you know, it's our CD release, and we didn't want to play after any of these bands,
cause right.
It's really intimidating to play after all these badass bands, but we're like, fuck, it's our CD release party, I guess. Let's just do it. And if people don't stick around and we're playing for fucking ourselves, then
the crickets. The crickets.
Yep.
Yep. Taillights.
We're gonna go on at midnight and play the whole album from first song to last song.
Yep.
Nice.
Hopefully. If we have enough time.
And it's a long CD. So might get boring. Really
so cool. How many tracks are going to be on the CD?
11.
11.
I thought it was 12. Well,
11. There will be 11 tracks. 11.
And the secret one.
It's no longer secret, man. You just fucking ruined it, man.
I know.
What a dick.
Ryan fucking ruined it.
What a peel.
Let me guess, you guys are going to do a Carcass cover.
No. Oh, no, we did that in Legion.
Damn it. Let me see here.
Legion did all the good covers.
But we did them really badly.
Bastards.
So it evens out.
We did it really badly.
So, yeah, 11 tracks on this. I believe it clocks in at just under, like, 56 minutes or some shit.
Nice.
Like that. Yeah, and intros and all.
An hour's worth of brutal beating.
Yeah, for the most part.
Nice.
Yeah, quite a bit of heaviness.
Now I've seen you post about times in the studio where you write the song, you have the songs written as far as musically, and then you're just beating the piss out of yourself to get your lyrics together. How is it to put the thing together like that in that, you know, when you're in the studio? How difficult is that?
Vocally?
Yeah.
It's horse shit. It fucking sucks. Unfortunately, this is something that's just honestly, it's me procrastinating. It's all my fault. I throw no blame to anywhere else but myself. I write songs
to make the whole world sing?
Immediately stuck in my head before you even said anything, not even your fault. I hear riffs. I hear vocal riffs. I've always heard vocal riffs. So I get this melody of vocal rhythm, and I pull a John Tardy, and I just fucking mumble shit. And that's the vocal lines for the longest time, and I put off writing real lyrics for so long, and then all of a sudden Legion or Master say, hey, we're going to the studio tomorrow, and the CD comes out in a week, and we're going to go on tour.
Right.
Oh, shit. Okay.
You're under the gun.
Nine songs I got to finish fucking writing.
Well,
I know how they go,
but
I just don't
have the lyrics. You seem like you work well under pressure, though.
No, okay. So what I'm getting at is this CD, when every time I've had to do that in the past, which has been almost every time I've recorded,
right,
has been a disappointment on my part. I've been disappointed in how it's come out, including Legion. I feel like I could have done better, and Legion deserved to have me do better lyrically and vocally than I did. I did those all last minute and under pressure, and I think I suffered for it. However, for whatever reason, with this CD and with Mastiff, it was also under the same kind of pressure. Although I saw it coming, I knew I was going to do this, and I ended up writing a lot of cool shit that I like, that I'm I'm pretty proud of. I like my structures. I like the lyrics better than a lot of what I've done in the past.
So you're learning from your
Yes and no. I still procrastinated a bit too much.
No, I mean lyrically. Really, when you sit down and you're actually hashing them out, you actually are able to focus your mayhem.
Yeah, a bit more. And you know, really, I just another big part of it is I just had a lot more subject matter in mind to write about. I didn't have to think of stories and like just cool metal things to talk about. I've gotten into a lot more issues and things that I kind of incorporate into the Mastiff ambiance, for lack of better terms.
Sure.
So,
like the trade.
Yeah, like the trade and Aphotic and Birth of Sorrow and Pareidolia and most of the songs. I think Heathen Colony is one of the few. Heathen Colony, maybe Sweet Taste of a Bitter Revenge, are a couple of the only examples of songs that are dumb guy metal songs.
Right.
The majority of them I tried to have to be meaningful. Gojira's been we just played Gojira. They're a very inspirational band vocally and lyrically to me. They show me that you can be deep and emotional and dark and whatever, but still be brutal and metal as fuck and heavy and, you know, and,
right.
And so a lot of the songs in Mastiff vocally and lyrically, I tried to kind of go that direction because it's been a big inspiration for me. But then Heathen Colony is pretty much about going to a metal show and throwing down.
Right.
The Sweet Taste of a Bitter Revenge is it's a rewrite of an old song I had about getting revenge. It's just Tarantino style, just, you know, hate breed fucking, you piss me off, so now I kill you and gut you and your family and
shit. I win.
Yeah. Yeah.
You lose.
But overall, this vocal writing process was a lot more fun and a lot more rewarding, and I'm really proud of it.
Awesome, dude.
I hope people.
You can't really ask for more than that if you know.
Not really. No.
You're happy with the final product.
I can still nitpick. We've had this discussion. We could still sit down and pick apart each of our fucking tracks.
How could you not? If you're,
absolutely.
You're gonna be. I mean, I think every musician is somewhat of perfectionist when it comes to that shit too. You know, like I could have, got my tone to sound better. I could have done this solo better here. Or, you know, we could have extended this part here. Or that, you know what I mean? Even when you write a song and you play it a few times out, and you're like, oh man, there's something missing here. You know what I mean? And you go back and you change it, and then you bring it back out, and they go, is that the same song? And you're like, yeah, that's the same song. We just added this little cool
new one. So it's kind of like live and learn. You know, what we did this time around, we kind of put the cabbage before the horse. Little rickism I made up. But, you know, we're not going to book the show before we haven't even tracked, you know?
Right.
Because we kind of gave ourselves that deadline. You know, we shot ourselves in the foot, you know, but thankfully we had Will Marvelous on our side. That
yeah, it was marvelous.
Totally, He made it happen. We stuck to our deadlines. We met all our deadlines, and you know, we're kind of celebrating. Hopefully. We don't even know if we're going to have a CD at this show because it's at the printers.
The cabbage?
Yeah.
Before the cart.
The cabbage before the horse? What are they?
Yeah, that's what you said, horse. I thought you said cart, but it's...
I just did 10 sit-ups now laughing. Yeah. Thank you for that.
So that's hilarious. I mean, live and learn.
I was really...
We're going to book the CD show after we get done.
No, we will have CDs for the show. It's...
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got to finish tracking. That's not we got to finish tracking. We have 3 songs that aren't even finished being written yet.
Oh, yeah.
And we got a CD release show in 8 days.
Artwork's done.
Yeah, artwork's done. That's what's most important.
Yeah.
CD layout. Thank you, done. Tony Cole. Thank you, Jordan.
And Jordan. Tony and Jordan. Tony Cole and Jordan.
Jordan Swanson?
Jordan Swanson.
Jordan Swanson. Jordan Dwayne.
Do the layout.
Yep.
Yeah.
Did a phenomenal job.
Yep.
Dude, it amazes me how talented that fucker is, man. You know what I mean?
He's a jack of all trades.
Sometimes I really want to cut him. Man.
I want to cut him all the time because I loved having him out in the show for so long, and I thought for sure that he would stick around, and he's got so much going on, man. Yeah. It's fucking impossible to...
Started on fire last night. What's up with that?
I have no idea, dude. I'm like, well, at least you weren't in it, and then he fucking, like, 4 hours later, he goes, actually, I was in it. It's like, what the fuck, dude? Holy shit. Driving down the road, fucking flame ball of flames and shit, you know? So, I mean, now with how do you guys feel as musicians? How do you feel that your pieces and parts are coming together as far as putting things in order? Like, Kevin's like, I don't even want to talk, and you guys are fucking making me talk.
I don't know. I'm kind of like Al, where I just kind of, I mean, I have ideas of what I want to do, but I don't really solidify anything until I'm actually right there on the spot.
And right.
Like, each take I took sounded almost differently from, you know, pretty much differently from the first one. And,
right.
But I don't know. I feel good about them.
You guys are throwbacks to the old school way of, like, the Hendrix play, you know what I mean? Like, he would record something and never play it the same every, you know what I mean? Like, at different shows, it's all, but if you think about it, you're improvising over the material, you know what I mean? You're not setting it in stone until you get there, and you're like, okay, well, I kind of had a melody right here, kind of, this is how I had an idea.
Kind of, yeah.
For the longest time, it seems like we do. Like, we'll sit on a song before and after Ryan came in. We would sit on a song for a while as a band, and parts would continually change.
Right.
And a lot of times I'm the asshole that comes up, hey, can we do it 7 1/3 time instead of 8.
Oh, and he did
because
it
I
too.
Don't have to play any instruments
all the time.
So, it was so cute. Like we would be working on something, and Al would come up, and he just, can we try it like this, you know, and double time.
Everybody rolls their
whatever
eyes.
Whatever you want, man. I can do it like this. I can do it like this. It was awesome though. Because I know Al's the pseudo drummer at heart.
Yeah, I've been a wannabe drummer my whole life, so I think of, like, time signatures,
that.
And I think of, like, weird little, I don't know,
and
details.
It works
details.
Ways.
I detail songs.
It works both ways because lyrically, like you were talking earlier, a lot of his cadences and everything, he was recording my drums so he could write his lyrics and get the cadences, and I heard it. I mean, I was just like, what are you saying there?
So you mean he's feeling off of your drum beats?
Yeah,
I'm big on rhythm.
I told him, too, that I also will go along
with his
vocals. I mean...
I love the fact that I'm hearing right now that there are other people out there that do exactly what I do, because that's... I don't focus a lot on the guitars.
Okay, tell
my
me.
My whole thing isn't...
Tell me if we're on the same book. Let alone chapter page here.
Sure.
Okay. Now, a lot of the way that I write vocal, like I said a little bit ago, is that I don't do lyrics right away.
Right.
A lot of the time. Sometimes I think of cool words and then I try to figure out how to place them, whatever. But for the most part, I come up with rhythms. And that's because of my background in hip hop and rap.
Right.
I hear rhythms and I hear flow.
Yep.
One of the reasons I like one of the most hated bands in death metal is Black Dahlia Murder, because they're really fucking catchy. I like catchy bands. I like shit where, like, you can hear the song once or twice, you leave the show and you know part of the chorus.
Right.
And hip hop did that for me. And it was more rhythm than it was, you know, flow or, you know, anything like that. Or, you know, sometimes it was the way one part flowed into another. Flew. I almost said that.
Flew into a cuckoo's nest.
But that was a big part. And so rhythm section, relying on both Neil and Aaron Ryan, Vocally, that's been, I rely on those guys a lot. And I think, I don't know, tell me if I'm wrong, that we kind of bounce off each other.
Oh, yeah. It's a trait of energy.
As you know, and you said that as well, Neil, when you know, working with Al so many times before, you know where he's at.
Oh, yeah.
And you guys both feel it. And I key in with the bass player a lot. That's why Jordan and I worked really well together when it came to things. And all the other bass players I've ever played with, I follow a lot of that shit, a lot of the drums, and always had fills, you know, ask the drummers to have little fills to key me in on certain things, or, you know, slides on a boom, you know, where guitarists, it's like a, you know what I mean? It's like it brings the front to it, you know, and the bottom really kind of gets me fucking shaken. You know what I mean? Like where, like you said, you're feeling the fucking, the pound.
Yeah,
of it, you know?
Yeah. I like to feel like I'm like the link between the rhythm and the melody.
Yeah. Yeah, you absolutely. Know, I feel the same way, man. It's fucking, it's, we're on the same page, man. And the nuances that you were talking about as well, when it comes to details about certain things, like, you know, we in Outside the Mirror, when we're writing songs right now, we're in the process of writing songs, these guys will have riffs and things together, and they'll have it all put together, and then I'll come in and I'll...
Skeleton. Yeah, they'll have a skeleton.
Yep, and you're adding a little spice here, adding a little spice there, you're fucking, you know, I'd be really cool to do this part here or extend this part, or sometimes I have a tendency to fall into the Brad thing where he used to do this with me, is we'd have something completely laid out, and he'd go, I want to take this part and put it here, and then, like, exchange it all, and then all of a sudden it ends up back around again where it was originally, with maybe a couple pieces
and question and answer type of writing. Yeah,
and that's it's difficult for the other musicians involved, because they're like, fuck man, we just had it and it just comes back,
but we already know how to play it this way.
Yeah, exactly. We're making it more difficult for it to be cool.
And again, and being a singer, I don't have to change anything,
right?
Exactly. We started doing it in the last like 3 or 4 songs that we were writing was taken away and make it a good song. Because we can write riff after riff, and does it make sense? Like, no, let's, like, write a good song. Take out all the bullshit.
Yeah.
And let's, like, White Raven. We took out maybe 2 minutes of that song to make it the way that it is.
Yeah. Well, you know, and Al, I think we fall in the same category with the hip-hop and the R&B stuff that we listen to as kids, you know what I mean, things like that, to where I've always thought that less is more. And when you can get something where you're not jamming 100 riffs in one song and a multiple changes here, here, and here, yes, it's cool. Yes, you're playing for other musicians that are going, damn, damn, damn. But the ones that you dumb it down for, the people that actually catch those catchy pieces. You know what I'm saying? Like, it gives somebody else's ears that aren't tuned to all the... Because musicians are tuned to changes. They're tuned to those changes. They're tuned to the tones. They're tuned to all that shit. But when you have the layman, the people that aren't in bands,
and just want to feel the rhythm, feel the groove.
Yeah, they want the catch. They want something that's going to pull them into the song.
And that's really what I wanted. My vision, my hope for Mastiff was from the beginning, which, you know, I did my best to manipulate the rest of the band into doing what I was hoping for. It was a lot of that groove, pocket, and not showing off too much. You know, we do a little bit of weird shit here and there, but for the most part, like Digging Graves on the CD is just total like rock and roll, laid back, groovy southern sounding simplicity with a little bit of thrash here and there. But you know, we do want to find more of the simplicity, going back to the roots and Pantera, and
as a singer, I think it allows you to be the singer that you want to be. It allows you to elaborate and
if there's anything that I am, it's wannabe.
There you go. Nice.
What is it that you want to be, though? I mean,
no, it's I would say that Mastiff does allow me to. One thing that did occur to me, and I don't know if this sounds, I don't know what the right term would be, a little silly to say or dramatic, I don't know, but one thing that I thought to myself when listening to one of the second or third mix or the first master, I don't know what it was that, you know, I think I found my voice.
Right.
That, I mean, all this time of me screaming and trying to figure out proper technique and, you know, and what sounds right and trying to get as low as I can, trying to get as high as I can without either one sounding like shit and whatever the case, Mastiff has this pace about us that allows me to kind of explore my range a little bit more without having to try as hard. Uh-huh. And I found that not trying has led to the best, my best sounds.
Right.
And that's what I like about Mastiff is that, that groove, like you said, the layman's type of just in the pocket, just the groove. And it, yeah, it allows me to just kind of like, I don't know. Sometimes
it's a common wavelength, I think.
That, sometimes know. I just...
You know, you scream. see yeah. sound waves, you know, when you look at an equalizer and you see those sound waves, you know, and if you pull too far out of those sound waves, I think other people's ears, I mean, musicians will always hear what you're trying to do, you know what I mean? You can always, it's like Necrophagist, you know what I mean? Like one of the, even Meshuggah at points, or Obscura, or any of those bands where they're doing so much. And all the guitar players and everybody who's really into that style of music are like, fuck it, these guys are badass. But then you hear, you know, the bands that people like are those ones that fall in that wavelength where it doesn't matter if you're a musician or if you're a fucking a watcher or enjoyer of music, you're going to hear that wave. It's going to tap you in every, you know, you're going to hit that fucking wave and ride it. You know what I'm saying?
I want to get tapped.
Yeah.
Tapped. Yeah, just keep it simple. You know, I don't know. That's just my philosophy.
Don't clog up the waves,
you
know, man.
I mean, you listen to like Pantera Walk. Dun, 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 yeah, dun. Yeah. I mean, it's fucking badass, but it's just right there, you know?
Some of the simplest shit is some of the most memorable shit.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I agree 100%. Go ahead, Limo. I see something coming up. There's something in your mind here. Wow.
We're kind of going into this next song that we got coming up, The Trade. Like a lot, we got a lot of like simple, heavy, groovy riffs.
True.
Coming very up true. In the song, and I feel like we're talking about that song.
Well, we should play that song then.
We should play that song.
So what's this one about?
This song's a bit deep, I guess, when you ask that question. This song was completely different, vocally, thematically. It was very different. Up until, this is one of those songs from the CD that got changed last minute, and it was, I don't know who had the idea first, but Limo and Neil both came to me and said, you know what would be cool is during the intro, if we had some kind of Native American type of tribal dance music going, it just sounds cool. And I'm like, well, lyrically it has absolutely nothing to do with the song, so I tell you what, being we got 3 weeks before we go in the studio, I'll completely scrap all my lyrics and I'll rewrite it, I'll make it have to do with some kind of something Native American so that we can pull that off. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, maybe that's horrible of me to do as a singer just to use an intro. Is that, I don't know, is that...
I think you're channeling some shit, man.
Like, yeah, the story is amazing, though.
Turned out good.
But so what I chose to go with, and I'm a bit ripping off, I believe it's Habitual Defilement. They already did a song about the Dakota 38, 38 Native Americans plus two other tribal leaders that were hung in Mankato, Minnesota. And Habitual Defilement, they did a song about it. And I kind of wanted to do our version of it. And it would definitely fit that. I hit up Jeremy Davis, a good friend of ours, an NYDM cat, about some, he's way into that shit. He knows tons of shit. So cool. All his posts and whatever. It's just, I don't know. It's really interesting. And he pointed me in the right direction of some proper songs to possibly use. And we narrowed it down to some really cool ones. And so the intro and outro, the intro to this song, which is, the song is entitled The Trade, The Ride. Google it, YouTube, whatever. There's two awesome documentaries. Two awesome documentaries that go very in-depth about everything. I'm not going to go into it all now. But the intro is a tribal, I believe it's a tribal war song of victory. And the outro is actually part of a song where five or six different tribes got together and all did their victory songs all at the same time. And it's a section of that. So it's really cool, and we just tried to fit it up with the song. Lyrically, you'll have to check it out when the CD comes out, and I strongly encourage everybody to look into. All you got to do is Google Dakota 38, and you'll get a ton of fucking information on it. Nice. So just look into it. It's definitely worth checking out, and something that everybody in Minnesota, let alone America, should, you know, at least be aware of and know about.
For sure, man, for sure. And then after that, we got some Sepultura. And then we have some Machine Head and some fucking caucus. We got some caucus. Since we were talking about caucus, and I got the Carcass fucking album the other day.
I like caucus better.
Caucus. Well, he's from Boston, so they got a caucus.
Caucus from around the way.
Yep. down at the car by the bar and shit like that. So we're going to listen to it. What's this one called again?
I don't know. Which one is this one? And this is the trade. This is the trade. The trade / the ride.
All right. Well, let's take a listen, folks. Stick around, and we will be a different color than white. All right. All right.
We'll be black.
All right. We'll be back. We'll be right back. Oh, a little carcass never hurts anyone, does it? It fucking makes you feel wonderful. Carcass makes me feel wonderful. Makes me want to punch people in the neck. So you have listened to the episode 127 with Mastiff. We're hanging out here, coming to the tail end of it, and you got to listen and sample some of their new stuff off their new album first. You got to hear it first. So go around and tell everybody how cool their new stuff is.
From the ass of Elvis.
That's from the ass of Elvis. And make sure that you're at their CD release show, which is April 15th at Club Underground. There are some amazing bands. It is a fucking action-packed lineup. If there was that lineup would be the Expendables of movie
fucking A, right?
Movie metal scene here.
Maybe maybe part three though.
Yeah, who would be Jean-Claude Van Damme in that lineup?
It's got to be us.
All right,
the worst guy.
So it'd be Wesley Snipes.
We're the worst guy. Yeah, Neil can be Wesley Snipes. So by default?
Who would be
Dolph Lundgren?
Who would be the Sylvester Stallone of that batch?
Well, whoever the oldest guy. Kevin. I don't know. I think I'm older. Hey.
I'm older.
I don't know.
I mean, Yo,
Adrian!
Canthrone's the pups.
Who would they be?
Pretty young
in
guys.
The Expendable. Who would they be?
Jackie Chan like was
Jet Li.
Jet Li.
Yeah.
They'd be the Jet Li.
They'd be the Jet Li.
Yeah. All right. So then, what would Glutton be? Where would they fall in that? Where would Gargatron fall in that? Would they be fucking? Would they be? Who is it? Chuck Norris? Would they be the Chuck Norris of it? There's no wrestlers.
Gargatron might be Dolph Lundgren. I mean, they're the I
must break.
I picture Dolph Lundgren when I picture Gargatron.
There you go.
Just big brutes. Yeah. Their music is so like strong sounding.
Right.
Even though they eat cheeseburgers for a living.
Fucking A, dude. Pizzas and cheeseburgers.
I think that's actually how they make their tour money.
Competitive eating.
But no, it is definitely it's a lineup that even if you hate our band, just come for the other bands because they're all fucking great.
That was really negative. That was a negative vibe.
I know. I'm saying regardless of what you think or even irregardless of what you think of Mastiff, the rest of the lineup is tremendous.
True.
Every band.
Tremendous.
Even any one band you hate, the rest of them are going to be cool. You're absolutely going to like at least one or five of the bands on the bill.
That's true.
And you're going to have a good time.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good
time.
Club Underground.
Yep. Lots of good drinks, stiff drinks being poured. Fucking good company. A lot of good people. Tots.
Tots.
Love their tots.
Their meatloaf is amazing. Their open-faced turkey sandwich is killer, too.
The spring wings. Yeah. They're awesome.
Those are pretty good, too, man. I've had some of them. Yeah, absolutely, dude. So what, you guys have other shows, or are we just going to focus on this one show?
We do have other shows. We are we're playing with Prong, correct?
Yep.
Is that May 29th? May 19th? That's what I said. Yeah. Pretty sure that's what I said, Heavy.
Don't pull out your space phone and look it up.
Don't be a dick about it.
Dates.
So you got Prong. Who's playing with Prong? Now, Prong is a fucking amazing old school dude.
The epitome of groove metal.
Beg to Differ is my fucking favorite album.
Prove you wrong,
dude.
It's quite the honor. That's pretty cool to be on that show. We're excited. The whole the heaviness, the groove.
Yeah,
it's
the club will shut down.
The show's been
completely
booked once already, and
that was
it was at Pav's right behind us, within puking distance of where we're at right now.
First time the band's at tour, so Tommy Victor couldn't play.
Right.
And then the second time was Pav's. Shut down.
I don't know what you're talking about. Talking into the microphone. What
did
you say?
The show was booked three times, I guess.
Jesus.
It was the first time.
Well, that's right. He was on tour with Danzig, right? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, and then the second time, Pavs, and then now we got this. So.
Unbelievable. Well, let's hope that the club doesn't shut down or fucking Tommy doesn't explode or implode or something. Fucking, they just came out with a new album too, right?
I was just going to say, I've heard No Absolutes, I believe it's called.
Yeah.
Really fucking good. I mean, not that I'm completely shocked by that, but like they're still Prong with this really cool modern sound. That's
right.
I don't know, that whole Back with a Vengeance type of fucking stereotypical phrasing that you would
this
use.
This time it's for real.
Yeah, it's really fucking good. Right. I think kids will dig it. People that have never heard of Prong before will dig it.
Yeah.
And I think Prong fans will dig it. I dig it. I think it's
Prong
great.
Prong will probably dig it, too.
Prong might dig it. I don't know. But if they're anything like us, this is shit.
Yeah.
But we're done.
Who's all on that? Who's on that bill? The Prong bill.
Tempestuous is on that, right? Cantherone. Tempestuous.
Yeah.
Cantherone.
Tomorrow brings new blood.
Yep.
But what about yesterday's new blood?
No, that's old shit.
Okay.
It's old news.
It's all coagulated. Get
with the program, Greg.
Just
all right, man. Yesterday's
coagulated by this time.
Yeah, it's
making sure. Fucking just
got all coagulated.
Clarify.
Is there somebody on that bill we're missing?
I think so.
I feel like there's somebody we're missing, and I'm gonna be
fucking Aaron's Facebook, and he ain't even fucking.
Who's on that Prong bill?
He's got that smartphone.
Because there's not. They're all good bands, and every one of them is worth mentioning. So,
do I have to go find it myself?
We got a fucking.
Damn it. You guys are supposed to be.
We
together.
Got an Android race here going on.
Oh, Android! Is it Android against Apple? Is that the deal? Oh, Jesus! Let's see. What do we got? You got the Prong show, and then what else do you have? Do you have anything?
We're going to Madison after the CD release show.
Yeah, the day after a CD release show, which I don't know if we've actually really talked all that much about, but
Cantherone, Mastiff,
the lineup we did,
Endless Rain, Tempestuous,
Endless Rain.
Endless Rain,
and The Other Day Brings New Blood.
Yes.
Sorry, Wade. I love you, buddy.
A couple of days from now brings new blood.
Yep.
Yeah. And then what else we got? Yes, the Midsummer
Night Dream.
Night Dream, yep.
Midsummer
2 days at the Club Underground that we've been talking so much about. 2 days of vomit, worth of vomit will be.
That's a hell of a lineup as well, isn't it?
There are some awesome bands. Ex-Mastiff drummer Brad Miller's band, Among the Serpents.
I just saw those guys the other
day. Before.
They were fucking amazing.
Yep, they're badass. I don't know. Just go look at the flyer. All the bands.
Day one.
There's not one
Friday,
shitty band
July 22nd. That's at Club Underpants as well. Mortificator, Digoro, Krog, Among the Serpents, Beastface, and Hex of Vorticis. Day two is Climactic, Ghost Hook, Mastiff, Echoes of the Fallen, Etheric, Cymothwa, and Trail Boss. Jesus. Dude.
See, like all fucking. He's smart. All great bands.
He is pretty smart. He's a jack off of all trades.
You know what you do when you book a show? You book good bands.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's the only way to get there. And you have good drink specials.
Yep.
What's the one mistake? What's that?
Mastiff. we're what the promoters call leeway.
Self-deprecating.
Margin of error.
Leeway was a great band from New York.
They were.
Excellent band.
Yes.
Born! Two, expire. You guys know any of that shit? Old Leeway? None of that? Oh, my God.
I
heard of expire.
Huh? That shit's good stuff, man. So how about merch, man? You guys going to have merch for sale?
That's a touchy subject for us. We're angry right now. Now, we've done some last-minute shopping for some T-shirts. We were hoping to get some really pretty full-color crazy shit for the show, but it's been a little bit last minute trying to get all the tracking finalized, mixed and mastered and layout and blah blah blah, so merch kind of fell second place to all that, as it should, I guess. But but we do have T-shirts. We'll have our
all girl sizes.
Yeah I mean, because that's pretty much our crowd, you know, so we cater to that.
Girls with big boobs.
Limo's got the lineup for this. I think this is the one that Greg was saying. Oh, Nonetheless too, did you mention them?
No.
Nonetheless, fucking great band. Tempestuous, We Are Legion, Endless Rain, Mastiff. This is that What Lies Below Metal Fest in Bemidji, I believe. I'm not looking.
Yeah.
Now I'm gonna look.
Yep.
It is Bemidji.
July 30th.
I can read this shit anyway.
What's the club up there?
Toddies, as in hot toddy.
Hot toddies.
Hot toddies.
Toddies. Nice.
Yeah.
Grill.
Yeah. So,
like Todd?
I don't know.
Like the Todd?
It just says toddies, man. I don't read into
the
shit.
Toddy.
You know? I try not to get too philosophical.
Well, thanks to the Todd. We appreciate you, Todd.
Thanks, Todd.
And we got that one in June. Cerberus Fest? Is that
Cerberus Fest.
Cerberus.
I've been wondering how to pronounce that.
Cerberus.
And that's at Club Underground. Cerberus. And that's
who's all on that?
Who's on that one?
Milestone, Casket Robbery, Mastiff.
You.
Decivilize.
You.
Kabbalah.
Kabbalah. Karma Sutra. Hailing.
Hailing Andromeda.
Yep.
It's June 18th at Club Underground.
You guys are booked up.
Club Underground. Yep. We haven't played there. That's new and exciting.
That's our jam.
We should play there more often.
I think so.
Yeah, absolutely, man. At least people know where to find you.
Yeah.
I mean,
on a weekly basis.
If there is like,
don't worry, we'll be there. Where are you guys playing? You'll never guess. Downstairs in a place called Club.
Ever done a year-long residency? We have. Club Underground.
Yeah. I miss Station 4. That was such
yeah, me place. Too.
I don't.
Club Underground's the new Station 4. I love hanging there.
The mini Station 4.
Yeah, it's awesome.
The mini Station
4. It's one of those cool places where you can say, hey, can we get a show on this weekend? Yes, you can. Well, do you want me to tell you? No, it's cool. It's cool. Just tell me which bands are on the bill and the
Station
details.
Station 4 was, that was a tough place. You had to fill that place up or else if you had 11
people. Fool, what you talking about? You I played some empty motherfuckers
at Station
4. Yeah,
if you had
11
people out there,
I played for the Poles before. All right?
Fuck
it. Even my girlfriend was like, fuck this. This is shit.
Yeah.
I'm going to go drink outside on the sidewalk.
It sounded good. I mean,
no, yeah, that's true. That's true. I enjoyed every show I ever played there.
I miss that place so much.
April 16th at Madison at the Wisco. We got us, All Out Mutiny, Beyond Atlas, and Disgusted One.
Have you guys played with that All Out Mutiny before?
No.
Have you heard them?
I have. I checked them out
good,
since getting on this show. They're and that Disgusted too, have you checked them out? Uh-huh. They got this teaser video on their page. It's scary.
Really?
Yeah, it's fucking
where are they from?
Angry sounding.
Madison
think
area?
They're from, yeah, I believe it's, I know it's Wisconsin, but I'm pretty sure it's Madison.
Wisconsin.
But they just got this just quick little teaser, just enough to like.
From Ed Gein's basement
gross
shit?
You out a little bit. Yeah, it's just some dirty sounding shit.
Nice, dude. Yeah, that All Out Mutiny, they're fucking pretty damn good. They hit me up when I posted about the bands and fucking wanting to play some shows, and they were like, fuck yeah, let's do it. They're good shit.
I dug what I heard so far.
They
I'm excited
me,
to
they
see
sent
them
me
live.
Some tracks.
Yeah.
Sent me some tracks. They
your
were
tracks?
Very cool about
tracks,
it.
Tracks, dear he?
Tracks, send all your tracks, RichmanIsPodcast@gmail.com.
Send them over.
Shit. Tracks, send them over on the choo-choo train tracks and shit.
What the fuck are we talking about?
No idea.
Stupid.
This is
just dumb.
It's gone.
Why are we allowed to do this?
I don't know, because it's fun. It's fun, right?
Hell yeah.
It is.
What else do we got? How can they,
we
they
do
book
this
you?
Tomorrow.
How can they book you guys? How can people book you?
Depends on who they is.
No,
I don't know. It's really simple. Offer us a show and we'll probably accept it.
How about Indiana? If somebody wanted you
absolutely.
To play.
Absolutely.
How about Omaha?
I think it would be a good challenge to come up with a place that we probably wouldn't play.
How about, I know one place you guys wouldn't play.
Where's that?
Colorado.
Off limits.
Yeah.
Fuck that.
You guys would be so stoned you wouldn't even know what to do.
We wouldn't make it to the state.
It'd be fun though.
Good show.
Good road trip.
What?
Get
play the show.
Edibles back.
Yeah.
Edibles?
Be all right with that.
Cannibals.
I'm all for going out of state, though. I thoroughly enjoy playing for people that have not seen us before.
Absolutely.
As much as
it
I like repeat
enough,
customers,
right?
I love seeing familiar faces as well, but it's a whole other type of coolness, too.
Now, is that something you guys are thinking about doing, too, man? Getting out on the road?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, as Limo mentioned, the day after our CD release show here at Club Underpants, we're going to, is it Milwaukee or Madison?
It's Madison.
Madison. That's
Madison. Madison. Yep. So we're,
at the Wisco.
That's, you know, that's out of town for us.
You guys ever played the Wisco?
No.
Have you played the Wisco?
Yep.
You have?
Yeah.
It's fucking
that's great.
It's
dirty.
Dude, that's somebody's
I've heard
house.
But
that's,
good
that's a fucking house. That, we played there. You and I played the same, didn't we?
Are you
Goatlard
sure?
We played at, Goatlard Fest, man.
Oh, that was there.
Remember
Goatlard
we played
that
place
was fucking
Wisco.
Awesome.
Yeah, dude.
That's the Wisco?
Yeah, with the fucking windows, dude.
I had a completely different place in mind. I didn't think I'd been there before.
Yeah, you'd been
Party
there
Central,
okay.
Madison,
I think
man.
I have video of that.
That's where cocaine and cheese curds was put together right
ah,
there.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Ew! I lost my motherfucking guitar player, right? Lose the guitar player. I'm like, where the fuck did he go?
Like physically lost.
He's
not
gone.
Just like
he's
out
gone.
Of the band.
I'm
like
calling
you lost
I'm
him.
I'm calling him to go to the house where we're all hanging out at, and he jumped in some car with some dude to go do blow at the fucking and followed a bunch of chicks. So I call him on the phone and I go, where the fuck are you? And he goes, dude, I'm at this party. There are mountains of cocaine and chicks everywhere. Do you want me to come and get you? Because I will. And I go, fuck yeah, come and get me. And everybody else in the band in the van are going, no, 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 stay here, tell him to come back. They want to go, dude, you got to come back. I'll come back in like an hour. 4 hours later, fucking sun's starting to come up. Everybody's outside partying, fucking nowhere to be found. Then he stopped answering his fucking phone and fucking then he just shows up. And dude, apparently I blacked out and was walking through a casino with my boots unlaced and fucking
you did?
Throwing donuts at people and shit. Yeah, I don't remember that. Don't remember going into some convenience store, fucking dick hanging out of my pants. It's fun. Good shit.
This is why we play metal.
Yeah,
because absolutely. This is socially acceptable.
Why we go to Wisconsin.
Right.
Yes. Wisconsin is one of those places and you can really, you know,
let loose.
Ed Gein it, you know, make coffee tables and shit.
Some of my all-time favorite shows have been in Wisconsin and Iowa.
Yeah.
Yep. Some of the most unlikely places that people would think would be a tremendous, exciting fucking show.
Yeah. I need to make Iowa more often.
It's great. I need to get great there. Every time.
Yeah. What is the, is there a place to play down there anymore?
I don't know. It's been years for me.
Fucking Harry Mary's was great. The Runway right. was great. Fucking, God, there was
Toads, Mr. Toads or something like
never
that.
Never played
right?
there.
Yeah. What was that ballroom we played?
The Lumberyard was always a good place. Did you ever go to the Lumberyard?
Never played there either.
It's a strip club that you could go to, but it was BYOB. You could bring your own beer into the strip club.
Was there a club behind it or something?
It was like in the middle of nowhere. We took like a 45-minute drive, and we were at the strip club, and we had cases of beer, and I couldn't believe it. I was like, are you serious? We could bring beer?
Were there bullet holes in chicks? Were there bruised asses and shit?
Like, you could touch everything.
Oh.
Except for the yoo-hoo.
Yeah. The yoo-hoo?
The who name.
The yoo-hoo was off yoo-hoo. Limits, huh?
Yeah.
Well, that's just a tasty chocolate drink.
And nothing on the mouth. No well, kissing.
I seen a
anal, but no kissing.
I seen a guy at the Double Deuce back in the day, right? Up against his fucking bachelor party, and all of his buddies are throwing dollar bills in front of him, right? And this chick is fucking rubbing her coos right in front of him, dude, and sticks her fingers in his mouth. And I was like, no!
he was
so into it, and all of his friends are going, ah!
No!
And she's like looking at him all fucking, you know? Into it and shit. Oh, dude.
That's
how you catch a disease.
Yeah.
If you
caught it, you got it from me. That's, you know.
That's a quick way to cottage cheese tongue right there.
Oh, man. What was that shit that Michael Douglas had? Wasn't that some sort of HPV virus in his throat or something from eating too many strange pusses?
Probably had a beer bush.
Yeah.
Beer bush. Beard bush?
A beer bush.
A beer bush.
Yeah.
Full of yeast.
Froth?
Yeasty.
It's got a nice frothy head on the top of it.
Full of hops. Very hoppy vagina.
That's an IPA vagina.
It creates its own booze with all the yeast up in there.
Vagina Nevada? That's fucking great, dude.
You should be taking notes for the next
You
album.
Should be. That's a good one. So, we're kind of down to the tail
Sorry,
end
Sorry, Mom.
Here. We're on the tail end here, fellas. So where can people reach you anyways? We didn't get to that.
Well, obviously Facebook.
You guys have a page?
Yeah, we're Mastiff with all capital letters, Mastiff Minnesota. Mastiff MN, I should say. You may also get the equally awesome Mastiff from England if you search it, but they're also cool. But we don't have any. We ZeroBudgetRecords.com. You can find our information and shit on there, as well as links to our contacts and the TwinTownTyrantRecords.com as well. Pretty much the same principle.
Which I think is right? down right now.
Is it?
I think their site's down right now.
Uh-oh. Is it down like a clown Charlie?
What the fuck did you just say?
Down like a clown Charlie Brown. Down like a clown Charlie Brown.
That was fucking awesome, dude. That was awesome. I don't even think you're that fucked up right now, are
Jimmy,
you?
Jimmy, right?
No.
It's Jimmy. Okay. What a beautiful audience.
Jimmy.
Thank you. What a beautiful audience.
All right, so we got one more song to play. We got some Man Must Die.
Yes.
And where'd that one come from?
That was my choice.
Yeah? Where'd you hear about this band at?
I don't actually know. It was one of those random finds, and it was just heavy
Spotify?
It was before Spotify.
They were an accidental find for me, too.
MySpace.
It was just one of those random death metal searches. You know, you go into the CD shop, you buy, like, oh, that band looks cool.
Yeah. That never happens, man. We were talking about this on one of our fucking other podcasts about how it used to be back in the day. You could find cool artwork, or you'd go, like,
the
that fucking...
Or the record label.
Oh, they're on
label.
Road racers.
Yeah, you just look at the record label and be like, oh, that's going to be awesome.
Metal Blade.
Century Media.
Metal Blade, yep.
Earache and, like, oh, yoink.
I spent all my money working at Taco John's doing random death metal searches.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And these are this is one of the finds. Where are they from? Do you know?
They're from Germany?
Germany.
I like how they kind of have that aborted type of, like, super clean produced sound. Like, you can hear everything, but, like, they get really fucking grindy,
it's
fast
just
shit.
Good.
But it's like a thrash metal band that does grindcore, kind of. I don't know. Yeah.
They're fucking awesome. Check it out.
Well, fucking hey, we're about to check
it
out.
In three
shit.
Is that what it is? This is one of my favorite songs.
You fucking people have been listening to episode 127 with Mastiff. And don't forget to check out their CD release show April 15th with Gorgatron, Glutton for Punishment, Cantherone, Elvis, Frank Sinatra, Dean Martin. Who else is on that bill?
Celine Dion.
I believe the Bieber tour is hooking up where they're
crossed.
So Bieber's going to be in.
Justin Bieber? We just don't want to compete, so we're trying to make
the
shows
to come over.
All one show.
Yeah. He's from Canada, so you might be in
luck. He's got that cool new metal logo, so we're like, you know what? Fuck it. Let's have him headline.
Bieber?
Yep, the Bieber logo. That.
Now, how did you guys get hooked up with the cat who did your logo?
Christoph Fatal. I've been working with that cat for many moons.
Yeah,
he's done many Legion logos. Yeah. Actually, he's done, I would say, close to 10 different, 6 to 10 different Legion logos. We Are Legion logos, and I'm a huge fan of his. He's
nice,
just a badass. Joshua Decker is another badass guy that does really cool logos and artwork, and he's also done a logo for us that
who did the artwork for the new Ashes of Elvis's
that's the artwork itself is Tony Cool.
Nice.
Done some Wake and the Cadaver, and he did Defler 8 Black Dahlia's cover, and
nice,
just shitloads of really awesome artwork. So he did the artwork for that. Christoph did the logo, and Mr. Swanson did the layout.
Swanson.
Chris, come over here.
Once again. You want a popsicle?
No offense, Meg, but you're an 18-year-old girl and I have no use for you.
We've taken it to a whole new level here, folks. Don't forget to check out RitualManusPodcast.com. On the right side, you'll be able to connect with us. iTunes, Stitcher, Facebook, Ritual Manus Podcast on Facebook, Ritual Manus MM on Twitter, Ritual Manus Podcast on Instagram, YouTube, bullshit. I just have that written out here. Bullshit. And then listen to my radio app, LISTN. Number two, my radio. You should be able to listen to this podcast here shortly, within a couple weeks here. We'll get everything out before you guys have your CD release show. Again, don't forget to check them out April 15th. Lots of cool bands and their new album. Are you guys going to be able to get it at Cheapo? Going to be able to get it at Cheapo?
Sure.
Yes.
Where else? Anywhere else? Electric Fetus?
Any of the local record shops that do work with the local underground.
Are you guys
going to
do
pretty
any?
Much going to try to take advantage of.
Are you going to do any kind of digital releases at all?
Twin
Absolutely.
Town.
What's that?
Twin Town's going to digitally release it.
Are
Twin
they?
Town Records.
Sweet. That's mighty nice of them.
Mighty wide of them, guys.
Mayors.
And, so don't forget to check these fellas out. We've got one more tune here. Anything else that you guys would like to add before we bail on this whole podcast thing here for the evening?
I got something quick. Thank you for checking us out, and we hope you dig it. But also, check out all the bands on our thanks list and any other bands that are on our page or that we've liked on our personal pages. Just check out local shit, that whole, you know, regular spiel.
That whole chestnut.
You never know when you're going to find your next favorite band.
You got to look for them though, and in the underground and the fucking the local scenes are where you're
you
gonna
have
find
to
them.
Search some of the best ones. Blue Ox is a great example. Those fucking assholes don't play shows hardly ever. They'll play one random fucking show. Yeah, they don't really get a promote hold of themselves or anything.
Yeah.
One of the best bands.
Oh, they're amazing.
They're one of my top five bands.
Oh, yeah, they're amazing.
Out of anybody, any up there with Slayer and Catalytic Decapitation, Blue Ox, and you wouldn't know it unless you look for them.
Right.
Because you have to.
I'm just going
to
start making patches and giving them to people so everybody has a Blue Ox patch. So they're going to go, where the fuck did you...
My personal point is just keep looking. Check out a band, play 30 seconds of a song. That's all we ask. And just see if you dig it. And move on to the next band and just keep trying new shit.
Absolutely. Guys, anybody else want to add anything else? Kevin, tell me something good. Tell me something good.
Nothing on my mind right now.
Nothing? Neil, how about you, sir? Don't clam up on me, Neil.
Come on,
motherfucker. Come on.
I'm just very thankful to be here on the show.
Nice.
Thank
very
you
good.
Very much for having us out here.
Thank you, Greg.
You're welcome. We Mr. Limo, Mr. Limo, what you got to say?
I just want to say that I love my mom. Love you, Mom. All I know right. you're listening.
We love your mom, too. We love all of our moms. Mamas. We're one of those bands that love our mothers.
That's awesome. How about you, Mr. Ryan?
Just a shout out to my daughter and my girlfriend. I'm sure they're Woo! Listening.
Yay!
I'm going to be mushy and say hi, Jax. I love you.
All right.
Please be
love
naked.
You too, Jax. Sarah. There you go.
And
word
thanks
up.
For having us.
Absolutely, dude, for sure. My pleasure, man. Anytime, you guys are all welcome. And anytime, if you see somebody that you know is coming on here, you can come and fucking bombard us. It'll be fun.
We're going to be here tomorrow.
All right. That's good. All right, so we got one more song here, and then we're out. Folks, this is 127. We've got, I believe, 125 to be released here this weekend sometime, and then 126, and then 127. So we're backed up. We got all kinds of good stuff on the way. Don't forget May 7th at Lee's Liquor Lounge. The Ritual Madness podcast presents Metal Day Mayo on Cinco de Mayo weekend. It's going to be a good time. Jack Daniels and Cokes for $2, PBRs, oh, Mortificator. Yeah. Blood War, Sin 7, and Psy Mothwa. You guys got to come check it out. It's going to be a good time. Going to do these monthly, so make sure if you're in a band, fucking get at me. We'll set some shit up. Ritual Madness Podcast at Gmail. Check it out, and we are out. Peace out, guys. You want to say goodbye?
Coke and mayo.
Coke and mayo?
Coke and mayo.
Mayo and coke. All right. We're going to snort some mayo and drink some coke.
Yeah.
Stay heavy.
All right,
stay
man.
Heavy.
Peace out, y'all.
Ritual Madness Podcast. Ritual Madness Podcast. Ritual Madness Podcast. Ritual